Hello and welcome to podcast 104 of James Bond Radio. With me is my good friend, Mr. or shall I say rather, Agent W. Sears. How are you doing, Tommy? Are you good?
I'm doing very well, mate. How are you doing?
I'm not doing too bad. I'm looking forward to this one. This has been a long time coming for me, the Octopussy review. And it's going to be interesting to revisit again because it's been a long time since I last saw it, a long time.
Yeah, well, this is the thing, right? I've got some revelations about this because, well, first of all, the Octopussy holds a very special place in your heart, doesn't it? It's your favourite Roger, am I right in saying that?
I think, I can go through it later, yes, but it's definitely up there.
Because I remember when you briefly spoke to Roger after that, was it the Ian Fleming centenary event? Was it that night?
Yes, that's right.
You waited, you stalked Roger outside the stage door.
It was another one when we went to a Roger Moore talk, an interview with Roger Moore, and then we met him afterwards when we had his book signing, wasn't it?
Okay.
I think that was it. Anyway.
Yes, and you said to him, The Octopussy is one of your favourite films of all time. And I remember you saying that he just broke out into a huge grin and it made you feel warm and fuzzy. So I know Octopussy holds a very special place in your heart. Now, on the other side of that coin, I came to a conclusion and a realisation when I was watching Octopussy that I think, with the obvious exception, this is the Bond film I've probably watched the least out of all of them. Because I'm watching it, and again, it's same for me. I haven't watched it in several years because obviously with the podcast, we made that sort of rule, haven't we, that we don't watch them again until we reach into the podcast. And I'm watching that, I'm like, damn, a lot of this is not familiar to me. Like, you know, I can put Goldfinger on and I've seen it so many times. I have every scene etched into my brain. Octopussy is a different beast for me, man. I couldn't even guess how many times I've seen it over the years, because there's so many things that, of course, I remember a lot of it, but like in terms of it being etched on my brain, it's just not there compared to all the other ones. So it's going to be interesting to get stuck into this.
I think that's really exciting, because I know before we said the ultimate thing with having a Bond film that you've never seen before or parts of a Bond film that you've never seen before, so that's kind of along that line, isn't it, really?
So
prior to watching it then, what were your thoughts, or did you not have much memory on it or anything like that?
Well, the thing with Octopussy is this, right? It gets a lot of flack, doesn't it? It gets a lot of flack. I've seen some conversations on the old Facebooks within like the last few weeks where it's come up, and it does not get very much in the way of positivity at all. When I think about it, like there are, you know, a big problem for a lot of people is obviously the clown suit that always comes up. The clown suit, it's like when you mention Man with the Golden Gun and they talk about the penny whistle, the clown suit always comes up. There is also the thing of, you know, Roger's knocking on a little bit by this point and all that kind of stuff, which are all fair points, I think. So it's a funny one to go in to it with that knowledge, but at the same time, like I always try and do, and I think you always do the same, is okay, let's pretend we've not seen this before, let's kind of go into this with fresh eyes, wipe away all the expectations and all that kind of stuff, and just see how it makes you feel and just go through it like that. So, man, I'm excited to talk about this. Cause A, because I know you love it so much, and B, because it's a newer experience for me in a sense. It's going to be good, yeah.
Excellent. Oh, that sounds cool. Well, speaking of Bond-type stuff, I had a pretty cool weekend last weekend, and I have to mention it just because, you know, you do stuff in your life sometimes and you feel like Bond. Sometimes you might say a line, or you know, like you went to the Spy Museum and you felt a bit Bond.
Yeah.
So last weekend, I had a mate who was over, and we did a couple of, it was basically an adventure weekend. So like the first day we went free diving. So there's this quarry with all these military vehicles sunken underneath.
Right.
So you can swim, you sort of dive down, take a deep breath, dive down, and you swim through these sort of tanks and trucks and aeroplanes and stuff like that, which is really cool. But also there's like this sort of pontoon where the divers jump off and stuff like that. And we were swimming underneath that, and it reminded me so much of In a View to a Kill, you know, when he's when there's Zorin's pumping station, and he's just sort of spying on the pumping station, and you can see him just like at one point I let my mate sort of swim ahead and I stayed back just so I could hide behind this little sort of barrier that I could peek out, and then and then when he went to turn around I dived underneath so he didn't see where I was, and there was a sunken bus as well, which was a bit like Live and Let Die. you know, the one that had gone into the swamp sort of thing. So yeah, it felt really cool.
Now let me
really
ask you a question. So when you do this free diving, so you don't have any kind of mouthpiece in or anything at all?
No. So
just a pair of goggles on.
Yep. Got your mask on.
Totally naked apart from that, right?
Totally naked. Yeah. It's pretty much like Honey Rider from the book. I've got like a knife strapped to my waist and I've got my mask.
Here's my question. If you were to make it truly Bondian, here's my question. Did you or did you not swim down to one of those sunken vehicles and get a little bit of air out of the tyres?
You know what? We actually talked about that. And my mate's got an underwater camera, but we didn't have enough. There wasn't enough. The memory on it had gone, but we're going to go again in 2 weeks' time. So I guarantee I'm going to get footage of hopefully me. If there's any air left in the tyres, I'm going to have to do it.
Sweet, man. That'll be cool. Yeah,
I don't think there's a Rolls Royce down there, though. That's the only thing.
That's probably an unlikelihood. Do you know, I remember years ago when I was a kid, I did like a little scuba diving course because my older brother was well into scuba diving for a while. So I did like the basic training course. And part of the training there is like, for example, if your air tank like breaches or whatever, and all the bubbles start pissing out while you're underwater, you can actually like put your mouth over that and breathe that air, even though you've got nothing in your mouth. It's the weirdest sensation ever. But I remember thinking, even back then, I was probably about 12 or 13 years old. I remember thinking of A View to a Kill then, being like, this is a bit like when he gets the air out of the tires in A View to a Kill. It was nice. I liked it.
That is good. That's good. That's really good, actually. Yeah. And then the next day we did a gorge walking thing where I don't know if I mentioned about that before. You basically, you got your wetsuit on, you got your life jacket, and you're sort of floating down rivers, jumping off rocks and stuff like this. But there was one point where it was basically chest deep water and we had to wade through it. It's sort of waist to chest deep. Mm. And there was a group of us walking and it felt just like Dr. No. You know, in the swamp when he's in Crab Key and we're all walking. And I was imagining that there were sort of guards and dogs behind us. And yeah, that was really cool. I just love little moments like that.
Do you think there is any danger that we're ever actually going to grow up and start behaving like adults?
I don't think so. No.
Me either.
I don't think there will be. I hope not. I still want to be like in my 50s doing stuff like that. But I don't know. We'll see.
I'm sure it will happen. I can't see it ever changing, to be honest. But yeah, no. Cool stuff. Wicked. Yeah. So in other news, the JBR t-shirt campaign is now over, sadly. Yesterday, July 14th, was the last day you could have got those. So congratulations to everybody that they got yourself a t-shirt. Sounds like we had a few sort of glitches with this particular website, so if you had some troubles, apologies for that, but there was a few sort of technical hitches along the way with this particular one, not with the t-shirts themselves, just with like the ordering process and all that kind of stuff. So apologies for that if you did have any troubles, but when we do another run on the old t-shirts, we'll iron those things out. But it's a tricky one because there's all sorts of things to take into account, like shipping fees, like some companies wanted to charge a fortune for shipping, and like obviously we got listeners in the States, the UK, all over the world, and this was like the lesser of all evils to make it easier for the most people kind of thing. But you know, we sold a good few t-shirts and stuff, so it was all good.
It'd be great to see, obviously, like last time we did the t-shirts, we want people sending pictures themselves wearing your t-shirts, whether you're at a James Bond location, whether you're, you know, out to dinner, whether you're on a date, whether you're whatever you're happen
whether you're
to
making
doing.
Love to a lady, you can have your JBR t-shirt on as well. Yeah,
that'll give you prime place in the Hall of Fame.
Indeed, indeed. Which should be mentioned, if you go to jamesbondradio.com, if you are a JBR t-shirt owner, make sure you go to the JBR Listener Hall of Fame on the website. You'll see the little thing in the sidebar. And upload a picture of you wearing your t-shirt, and then you'll be immortalized forever as a JBR Listener Hall of Famer. Absolutely.
That'll be good. I can't wait to see those flooding in.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, last time, in fact, and the time before, we mentioned about the little game we were going to play, keeping an eye on Daniel's schedule. Mm. Now, there are a couple of other things that have come to light.
We should explain what that is for those who have just joined us for the first time. Basically, the idea was, all the panic that was going on about, oh my God, Daniel's not going to be Bond, all that stuff in the press, still suspiciously silent, isn't he? You know, if all that stuff was true that was being reported last month or whatever, it's still a little bit on the quiet side, isn't it? So basically the idea was, okay, Daniel's signing up for all these roles and stuff, TV shows and all the rest of it. And the idea was, okay, he's an actor. He's going to do other roles, of course. You know, Pierce was doing Dante's Peak, for example, you know, in his Bond years and all those kinds of movies.
Cracking.
Right? yeah. So, of course, he's going to be in other stuff. And the sort of decision we came to was, okay, well, let's look at the actual schedule of things he's signing up for. And in all likelihood, if it's like last time, the time between Skyfall and Spectre was 3 years. So in all likelihood, it's probably going to be that again for Bond 25. So essentially, Spectre started filming at the very end of 2014 for a 2015 release in October. So really, if his schedule starts going way into 2017, which is when, or sorry, 2018, that's in all likelihood when Bond 25 will be shot. If his schedule is going right into there, then we should start worrying.
Yeah.
If his schedule is full right up until the end of 2017, then we're still in the clear for Bond 25. As far as I'm concerned.
Well, this is exactly what I'm thinking. So we mentioned before the film, the Lucky Logan, I think it was Steven Soderbergh film. There was a TV series that he was sort of helping exec producing and starring in, Purity, I think it was 20 episodes. Now there's also another film called Kings, where he's starring opposite Halle Berry of your favorite film. And it's based on the LA riots in 1992. And Craig, I'll tell you a little blurb about it. Craig plays a guy called Ollie, a loner who lives in South Central, one of its only white residents, and he befriends and falls in love with Halle Berry's character, a tough, protective mother who looks after a group of kids. So when the riots explode in the city, Craig's character helps Berry to try and track down the kids from the worst of the violence. So, you know, it's quite a hard-hitting thing. But in terms of when it's likely to be filming, it's still scheduled with 2017 in mind. So even with all these things, it still looks as if 2018 is relatively clear at the moment. Yeah. So
that for me is like, with all the stuff in the press, it's like, okay, the things, when we, rather than everybody, you know, poop their pants about it, let's look at it logically, right? And I feel like this is the best way to do it. And it, even if his schedule does go into 2018, I would still be like, okay, do you know what? Okay, it's looking more likely that he's quit, but I would say that even if they put Bond 25 off until 2019, and that was going to be his last one, and he's like, yeah, you know what, I will do one more. Just give me a bit more time. Do you know what I mean? I could see that being a thing. I would say start worrying if 2018 starts filling up. But the only way I would say, right, let's throw the toys out of the pram and start crying, is if 2018 completely fills up and then 2019 completely fills up as well. Or he comes out and says, I'm bored, I don't want to do Bond anymore. And then we're all right. But the way I see it, man, all those reports that were in the news and on the press everywhere, none of it was backed up with anything remotely solid. And if that was true, I'm sure we'd have heard it from the horse's mouth by now, and we still haven't.
Definitely. Exactly. Definitely. Yeah. And also, it might seem quite a way away, you know, him, Bond 25 not starting until 2018 for maybe 2019 release. That is, still seems far away, but you've got to think that that's got given Eon a whole year between now and then to get this script, to develop it. We already know they've started to look for a story for Bond 25. Greg Wilson's sort of come out and said that. So it's already set in motion. So rather than almost filming too soon, even though we'd love to see one, hopefully this little extra time, whether Daniel does or doesn't play Bond, hopefully this bit of extra time will help, you know, get a really kick-ass script.
Yeah, absolutely. Anyway. And like we've said recently as well, I think it's a different world these days. And I don't think you can, with the amount that goes into a Bond, or making any film these days, any huge blockbuster like that, I think every 2 years on a regular basis is a tough thing to call. And I feel like it would be at the expense of quality at this point. As much as I would like to see a Bond film every other year, I just don't know if we live in that world where that's really possible anymore. Unless they went down the Lord of the Rings route and it was like, okay, let's batch film, you know, two or three at a time or something. But
I don't think they'll do.
I can't see that happening either. But
no,
there you go.
Definitely not. No.
Cool stuff.
So in other news then, thinking about the impossible, James Bond's watch is going on auction. Ooh. Now, this is one from On Her Majesty's Secret Service. Now, George, he wears at least two different types of watches. This one is the pre-Daytona Rolex. It's up for auction on the 18th of July, so not long. It comes with the original invoice upon which the words are written, "This is the watch for James Bond. And it's addressed to production supervisor David Middlemass at Eon Productions. So that's pretty cool. You get a nice little memento as well. And it also comes with a black and white photo of George wearing the watch alongside Katharina von Schell, who played Nancy in the film. So, Tom, are you going to put a bid in?
Mate, that would be a watch to own, wouldn't it? Good God.
It would.
It'll be interesting to see how that one goes, because like the watches are usually pretty hot stuff, aren't they? When they come up for auction, they usually go for a fair old back, don't they? And it'll be interesting, you know, say they auction Connery's watch from Goldfinger, you know that's going to be like, whoa, that's going to be a next level bidding, because not only do you get the hardcore Bond fans involved as well, you're going to get just hardcore movie fans who will want a piece of that action. And I feel like with Majesty's sort of dividing people, not so much in the Bond fan world these days, it gets a lot more respect than it used to, but like in the general sort of movie memorabilia world, I wonder whether I don't feel it would have as much power as a Goldfinger watch or, you know, a Spy Love Me watch or something like that, you know, those real massive hitting movies. I'll be interested to see how much this goes for, man.
Yeah, definitely. Well, we'll certainly keep an eye on it. Mm. Now, the other thing is, I think, like you said, Goldfinger watch, definitely it would go through the roof. But also this one, it didn't have any gadgets on it or anything like that. And I think if you get a gadget watch, remember Roger Moore's one from Live and Let Die, the spinning bezel, that went, and how cool would that have been? So it's obviously a straight watch, so to speak, without any gadgets. But yeah, so we'll keep an eye on that and see how that goes.
Speaking of George, actually. He's, as I mentioned on last week's little mini episode, George, for anybody that missed that, is making a special appearance in Oslo, Norway on the 1st of September. There's going to be a little Honor Majesty's Secret Service screening with a restored 4K version of Majesty's. George is going to be there. A lot of Bond girls are going to be there, yet to be announced and all that kind of stuff. So if you fancy that, check out, just type in James Bond in Oslo and you'll find that on Google. And that's going to be a cool day, organised by Morten Steengrimsen from the Norwegian Bond fan site. So make sure you check that out. And also, what's actually really cool as well is old Anthony Sinclair, the old famous tailor, is making George a special jacket just for the occasion. How cool is that?
Nice. Very nice.
Yeah.
I wonder if it will have like a little inbuilt holster in the...
would hope, yes.
Yeah.
Just to allow the shoulder holster in there without being noticed. Yeah, I like it.
Nice. That is cool. Speaking of cool stuff, I heard a really great story last week about... it's a World War II story. Mm. It's about a woman called Beatrice Jackman. Now, she was a Brit who was living in Denmark during World War II. She was assisting the Danish government. Obviously, that was occupied by the Nazis at the time, Denmark. And she was working as a special operations executive. So she was basically an agent. Now, it's only come to light recently that she was a part of this. And she was carried around a Bond-like fountain pen, which is quite interesting, seeing as we've got Octopussy later on. Now, within this fountain pen was a 3-inch blade. That was hidden by a screw cap that she could take off. Obviously, if she was in a situation that needed it, she had it on herself, just sort of protection or whatever else it was needed for. Now, this pen was provided by MI9. Now, we all know MI5, home sort of security, MI6, obviously foreign. Now, MI9, this was the department responsible for producing concealed weapons, facilitating the escape of British POWs, and the return of those who evaded capture. So this is quite cool. I like, there were quite a few MI, different sort of MI departments.
Yeah.
And so this was MI9. So she was obviously trying to help people who were captured in Denmark, you know, trying to help their release. Now, this pen was discovered on her desk with the rest of her stationery when her estate was cleared out. She passed away, I think it was a couple of years ago or something, or you know, it wasn't too long ago. And they discovered this pen amongst all her other normal pens. And only then did they find out that she was actually an agent. And because the blade hadn't been taken out of the pen for decades, it was still in pristine condition and was as sharp as the day that it was given to
her. You're kidding
me. Now, just imagine if that was your gran, okay? And it's your sweet old gran, and you used to go around for tea and crumpets and see how she's doing. And then, you know, she's passed away. But then you find out, actually, your gran was a secret agent and she used to carry this around with her. How amazing would that be?
That would be incredible. Do you know what, man? That those stories I could listen to, of like those real spies during World War II, I could listen to all day long. There's that book I always talk about, don't I? It's called Secret Agents by David Stafford. It's all about the special operations executive during World War II. And it's like, it's, you can just feel the DNA of Bond in some of those stories. And, you know, they're true. They actually happened. And that's, oh man, imagine that if your granny was like a super spy during World War II. How cool would that
so
be?
So cool, wouldn't it? So cool. But you would want to keep it as like a souvenir then.
Yeah, of course you would.
As your keepsake sort of thing. You'd I don't know whether you'd sort of, I don't know whether you'd keep it on your person just in case, or whether you'd like have it as an exhibit with the actual blade, you know.
Do you know what, I'll tell you what I would show. Do. I would have it in a display case, like when you used to have one of the golden guns. I'd have it in a display case as like an artifact, but then I'd get a replica made for everyday use. That's what I would do, and then I wouldn't worry about losing it so much, you know.
Yeah, yeah. But, a replica with a blade or without a blade?
Maybe with a blade, or you know, maybe with some like acid in it or something. You know,
acid.
You
know, sounds good. Okay, cool.
So good old Beatrice Jackman, a granny with secrets, obviously. Mm. Good stuff. Cool. So obviously, we're going to be talking about Octopussy today, part one of our Octopussy review. Very excited about that. Before we get cracking in a few moments, make sure you come and join us on Facebook. Just put James Bond Radio into the Facebook search, and you'll come and you'll find us. If you haven't joined our Facebook page yet, then what are you waiting for? You're missing out on a whole part of the JBR family experience. That's where everybody does all the chit-chat and stuff. It's great.
Crazy, crazy. Indeed. If you haven't joined, that's just crazy.
Indeed. So also come and join us on Twitter. That's just at James Bond Radio, and you can come follow us on there and tweet us. You can come to jamesbondradio.com. Over on that website, you can find all sorts of blog posts and stuff like that, and interesting articles and all the rest of it. Managed by good old Jack Lugo. You can also leave us a voicemail over there. There's a button on the right-hand side that says leave us a voicemail. You can leave us, you know, a listener quote or a question for a future mailbag episode, or you just want to say hi or whatever, or sing us a song. Whatever it is, you can do that through jamesbondradio.com. If you wouldn't mind visiting our iTunes page, if you just put James Bond Radio into the iTunes store search, you will find us. If you wouldn't mind leaving us a lovely glowing 5-star review, that is also very useful because it helps us rank higher in the searches and attract more listeners. And last but not least, there's a little donate button over on jamesbondradio.com. If you feel like donating to the JBR family cause, that's always appreciated. Never expected, no pressure, but if you've got a few quid burning a hole in your pocket and you want to support the JBR show, that's always appreciated. And we can. What can we buy you this week, Chris?
Well, I got the pants. I've saved up all the you know, sort of donations that we've had so far, and I managed to find a pair that actually fit me for once.
Oh, lovely!
You know, it took a while, but yeah. So I've got pants. I think what there's a pair of socks that, you know, I've stitched them up so many times. Yeah. It'd just be nice to have a new pair of socks. Yeah, so I think that's what the next donations would go on.
Sweet, man. So there you go. You've heard it from the horse's mouth. Good stuff. All right, cool. So before we crack on with the review, then it's time for a bit of Bond trivia, isn't it, Chris?
It is indeed. Now, who should go first? I think you should go first this week.
I'm going to go first. I'm going to claim it. Are you ready for it?
I am indeed.
My question to you, Mr. Christopher Wright, is throughout the entire Bond series of films, how many times do we see Bond on horseback? Ooh. That is, throughout the entire series of Bond films, how many times do we see Bond on horseback?
That is it. That's a thinker, isn't it? God,
it is.
That's a good question.
And there's a couple
that's a
in
really
there.
Good question.
There's a couple in there that are blinking you miss them. So,
yeah. Okay. Oh, God, I think that's going to stump me, but good question. Okay, so my question for this podcast is related to Octopussy. My question is, Mr. Tom Sears, when Kamal Khan threatens to extract information from Bond, what methods does Bond suggest Kamal will use on him?
Good one. All right, cool. Yes.
Okay.
Yes. All right. Excellent.
Lovely jubbly.
Cool. All right, then. Let's roll some theme tune and let's talk Octopussy.
Who are you?
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Bond.
James.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Keeping the British end up, sir.
Welcome to James Bond Radio. News, reviews, and discussion of all things 007.
No problem with female authority.
Oh, pipe down, 007.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
Oh. Righty-ho then. So let's start right at the beginning with some gun barrel action. Tell me what you think.
Okay, so, I mean, we've gone back to kind of a bit of a classic sounding gun barrel motif. Obviously, Fiori's Only, they mixed it up a bit, didn't they, with their gun barrel music. But, you know, it's not nice to get it back for it's a bit of a slower version as well, this one, I think. Slightly slower version of the Bond theme, but yeah, always good. But you know what, Tommy, I love, I'm going to say this a lot during this podcast, but these pre-title scene, I fucking love it so much. I love it, and I love it, and I want to marry it and have kids with it because I love it so much.
Now, I made an observation that it does apply to the pre-title sequence a little bit, but also to other parts of the film as well, which we'll get to later, which is, obviously, we've got John Barry back this time, right? We've been doing a lot of music-related podcasts lately, obviously. And in the previous film, Fury Eyes Only, we didn't have any John Barry. And there was loads of that stuff of how we were saying there was so much silence in that score, loads of action sequences with no music whatsoever. And that was kind of like, we sort of felt that that might have been a bit overdone, you know? I noticed in Octopussy, there's a fair bit of silence in that as well, but it is done to a masterful level this time, and I love it. So there's some, what I tell you what I like about this pre-title sequence is there's loads of sneaky Bond music, right?
Even in the daytime, it's still sneaky.
Even
it's
in the so daytime, good. Bond's rocking up, he's getting his disguise on, and we get some like real subtle Bond strings in there, and those, it's just, oh, I dig that a lot. And then it's obviously a skinful a little bit, but when he gets into the jet and that whole chase is going on, that's all completely silent until the very, very end. So it's interesting to see that. But I tell you what I do love about that is all that sneaky Bond music, man. I feel like that can make or break a pre-title sequence. And I feel like if you didn't have any of that in this pre-title sequence, it wouldn't be anywhere near as powerful as it is.
No. I think you're right. This, for me, in fact, it's one of my favourite cues from Octopussy, and it's brilliant. It's fantastic. But I love it. They open up on the open top Range Rover coming in. It's great. You see, they're at the sort of races. Bond gets off, and straight away he's into sneaky, where he takes off his jacket, turns it inside out, flips the hat over, and straight away he's sort of in disguise. And I think reversible jackets are the way of.
We were saying about the gadgets in the modern Bond films is how it's tricky to do it these days because everyone's got an iPhone and all that. And the gadgets of the 90s Bond films would just look silly by today's standards. And so on. But like things like something as simple as a reversible jacket is it's cool, isn't it? I want a reversible jacket. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. And it's not like it's high tech by any means, but it's cool and it's sneaky and I like it. Yeah.
Yeah. And I like it. And obviously he gets the little moustache put on and sounds like a load of ball, which is quite cool. And you see these sort of Fidel Castro-alikes who are looking at the races, and there's one guy who's just leching at Bianca's cleavage, like blatantly
as
obvious.
As you would, I mean, let's face it.
As you would, to be fair. And then she rocks away, obviously goes to help James get fixed up. And I love the bit where he's just... He's in costume now. He's going towards the airport hangar, and there's a guard that's stationed there, and he just sees his chest pocket's not done up properly and just flips it. And it's just the way that Roger does that is just so good, I think.
Do you know what, man? There's a lot about this film that a lot of people don't like, right?
Yeah.
And I can totally understand it. Obviously, we'll get into a lot of that stuff later. But there is some absolute top draw bondiness in this movie as well. Like one of my all-time favorite Bond moments that I think is one of the coolest things I've ever seen. And things like that arrogance to be like so in character of like, you know, the disguise he's in, just to add that little detail in there, man, it's brilliant. And I love it.
It's cool, isn't it? And I love the whole fact. So he goes in, there's a spy plane there, and he basically, you know, tells continue, and the guy goes over and whoosh. And Roger's good with the old hand chops, isn't he?
Oh, he's a judo chop master, let's face it.
He is a master at that. Obviously knocks the guy out, opens his briefcase. Nice hidden little bomb in the briefcase. Obviously we like that as well. Fix it onto the plane, and suddenly all the sort of barriers around it come down, and there's the real Colonel Toro that's seen him. And it's just brilliant because, like, if you hadn't seen that initially, you think, oh, Bond's got away with it. And then obviously you see Colonel Toro turn up and like, who's that guy? Mm. And then he gets busted and you think, oh, well, his mission over. That's it. They found the bomb. That's it. He's done and dusted now. So he gets back in the sort of army truck. under gunpoint. They take him away, and you're like, oh, what's gonna, you know, how's he gonna get out of this?
Mm.
But then Bianca sort of follows him, and this is really good. It's so cheesy, but it's great. So she's obviously rocking along in the Range Rover. There are two guards with guns, and she pulls alongside him, shows him a little bit of leg, you know, check out my legs. And they're sort of a bit distracted, and Roger's face when he's kind of like, go on, have a look, go on, have a look, check her out, have a look. And then obviously they both have a look, and he's like, right, parachute cord. And then they both fly off the back. So cool.
Yeah, man.
Do you like that scene, that little bit?
I tell you what, there's a lot going on with Octopussy. And I it's quite a long film, isn't it, when you think about it, when you put it all together. It's quite a long one. And I feel like what you have here is like you've got some real, like real, some people are going to go mental when I say this next sentence. You've got some real amazing, like, core Fleming Bondiness in there, right? Now, I know we're talking about Octopussy, which you wouldn't describe like that, but we'll get to that in a minute, right? Yeah. You've got some of that stuff, but you also have some real, like, borderline slapstick, not even borderline, some real slapstick stuff in there as well.
Yeah.
And you can look at it and be totally turned off by that
and
ruin the rest of it, which, you know, fair enough. But it's like with Roger, especially this period of Roger, like if you just embrace it and go with it, do you know what I mean? It's like there's a lot of fun to be had with it, and it does make me happy. And as ridiculous as that woman is, driving alongside and showing a bit of cleavage and a bit of leg, and these trained soldiers getting all hot and bothered and like, oh, look at that boobies. Do you know what I mean? It, as ridiculous as that is, it has to make you smile as well. Do you know what I mean? Especially when you see Roger's face, which is just a nugget of gold all by itself when you see his face, just like nudging and winking and stuff. So, yeah, I do like it. I do like it. But I think the danger lies with a lot of people listening to this. A lot of the danger lies in comparing this to something like Casino Royale or a Skyfall or a Quantum, because that's what Bond is today. And Bond wasn't that in 1983. You know what I mean? So it's like it's easy to look back on something and completely poo-poo it because of what's come since. And I think that's a mistake. I think, like we always say, embrace it for the time in which it was made, pretend it's 1983 again, and go with that. Do you know what I mean? That's my ethos anyway with this.
Yeah. I like it. I like it. I think that's one that I certainly take on board when I watch it. I think with Octopussy, obviously we'll go into it, but you get so many variations. You get some really good tense scenes. You get some good action, and you get some of the cheesiness. You get some of the sort of almost slapstick, or it, like you said, it is slapstick in a way, but it covers so many sort of variables.
I see what's interesting when you compare it to the previous film, because Fear Eyes Only is very grounded, and you could almost say, well, Octopussy was just jumping straight into the ridiculous side of things from that as the opposite sort of end of that spectrum. But I don't think that's really true. When you look at Fear Eyes Only, that pre-title sequence, keep your hair on, and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. And there's a lot of that kind of humor in Fear Eyes Only as well, probably toned down compared to Octopussy, obviously. But yeah, I think taking into account Roger's Bond, it feels right. I was expecting, because I hadn't seen it for so long, I was expecting to watch this and be like, oh, fucking hell, this is a bit ropey, isn't it? But I didn't get that feeling. I was if you accept Roger for who he was, and go with it. Like, it's a fun movie, man. It really is.
It really is. So they're on. They're, you know, Roger's joined Bianca. He's jumped in the Range Rover with her, and then you see the other sort of general in the front of the truck waving at her. And then Roger, he sees Roger. Roger shoots. Obviously, the truck goes off into some chicken farm. This farmer's like, "What's going on? Get out of here!" sort of thing. Now this next bit I think is amazing. So this is interesting. So he gives her a kiss and says, "I'll see you in Miami." And you're thinking, I wonder if they rendezvousing at the Fontainebleau Hotel.
Maybe.
But this bit, okay, is absolute genius. So he gets in the back of the horse box. All along, you think, well, you know, they've got a horse. That's all it is. It slows down. You just see the horse's ass come up. See that start of the sort of nose cone sort of spike thing of the Aquastar jet just come out. You're like, what the fuck? And then the wings come down. You hear the engine sort of accelerate and rev up, and the next scene is the scene I've probably reenacted the most in my life. When I was like a 6-7 year old boy, I'll be lying in bed, you know, doing the Aquastar movements and stuff like that, and I love the sound, the way that the missile is when it sort of launches off after him is brilliant. And it's so, you know, it gets close and he has to really rely on his skills, and the sound of the aeroplane when it sort of banks and curves and flips upside down and all that sort of stuff. I just love this thing.
It's, yeah. It's, I tell you what it is, when you see that plane come out the back, it's almost like a little Nelly moment, isn't it? In the sense it comes out and you're like, what? And it takes a moment to sort of twig because the wings are all folded up and stuff, and it's just this tiny little weird thing. And then the wings come down and off he goes. And it's it is like a little Nelly or something like that, isn't it? Or even it's even like you could almost compare it to the submarine Lotus as well. Do you know what I mean? It's sort of like it's a vehicle that it's not immediately obvious that it does what it does. And then it takes, and I tell you, man, it's got, I wouldn't say, obviously, it's not as iconic as the Lotus submarine or anything like that. But
it hasn't got any gadgets as such.
It hasn't got any gadgets, but it has a look to it, man, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I remember, if you see that on a poster, you're drawn to it, aren't you? It's got that sort of intrigue about it. Just the look and design of the thing. It's cool, man. I like it.
Yeah, one man jet sort of thing. But the whole idea that there's a Lantern missile chasing him, it's getting super close, he's only just avoiding it, and his mission is to blow up this sort of hangar.
Mm.
It gets foiled, what's he going to do? And suddenly a missile, he's going to blow up, and then he has the sort of the wit, the brains, the audacity to fly down towards his hangar. The missile's following him. And then these people made the same mistake they did in Live Let Die. It's like, close the hangar door. Which, if you think about it, would probably still not do them any good if he crashed into the hangar door, because I'm sure
the missile is still following. Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, and also the plane as well would create damage. But anyways, you know, they're maybe not the brightest sparks. Mm. So he sort of flies in, and the balls to fly in a plane into the hangar, banks it for, you know, so it's like vertically flying through. And obviously you see the doors closing, and it's just makes it at the last second, looks back just as the missile goes down, and you see Colonel Torres' face going, oh, shit. And then in probably one of the best miniature explosions I've ever seen on film, that final explosion, the hangar, is brilliant.
You know, man? I think with any pre-title sequence, you have to sort of look at it like, okay, Bond exists on a higher plane than other action movies. It's just...
I like the pun.
I didn't even mean to do that. It was automatic. I love it. It's flying through my veins, right? It exists on a higher plane, and there's always that bar gets raised, doesn't it? Of like, okay, remember that amazing free running sequence? How the hell do we top that? You know, remember this car chase? Remember, you know, that stunt or whatever? And you always got to try and beat it. And I think when you look at this pre-title sequence, and that, I mean, if you're the sort of person that's like, oh, Roger's too old, you know, oh, it's too silly or whatever, just look at that plane. And of course, there's some dodgy back projection where, you know, Roger's looking over his shoulder or whatever. Of course, it goes with the time. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But like that whole sort of sequence of flying the jet around and like narrowly missing those doors and coming out, man, that's a brilliant sequence, man. Yeah. A brilliant sequence. It's fucking cool. And like you say, it ties the whole thing up perfectly, because he tried to blow that thing up, that hangar. He gets foiled, and then he still gets the job done. Through probably the most high-risk way you could possibly imagine doing it. It's nice.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it? And then obviously after that, the plane, the hangar's blown up. And now this is a really interesting part. So obviously, he didn't have much fuel in that plane, did he? Because he's only been skimming around for a few minutes.
Do you know what? I imagine it's like in a car. The faster you drive the car, the quicker you burn your fuel up. So of course, I imagine the frantic nature of that chase burned up most of his fuel.
And also maybe... because it is a small jet, he only had to go over the next couple of hills to his next rendezvous point or whatever it is. Anyway, so he has to land. So he lands down and he goes along to this sort of gas station. Obviously, this old fella's there on a rocking chair, gets up and probably one of the cheesiest lines in the whole series. I think you could do it justice. Go on,
yeah. All right, I'll give this one. Fill her up, please. There it is.
Brilliant. Fantastic.
Do you know what I love, and what my favorite part of this entire pre-title sequence is? You can keep your Atco Star jet, you can keep your Bond music, you can keep all the rest of it. It's Roger's face at the end of that sequence when the shot freezes and it dissolves into the title sequence. That like chuffed grin that's on his face is brilliant. Smug. I want that. I want that blown up into a poster and have that hanging above my bed, man. Because that is a face. Okay. I love it.
It is. It is brilliant. It's sort of smug, but you kind of have to love it as well.
Yeah.
It's great. Now, here's an interesting question. I never thought about this when I was younger, but I have seen it written or people refer to it. Now, was the gas attendant, the gas pump old fella, was he a member of MI6 or not?
Why would you think he would be?
Well, personally, I never thought he was, but some people were saying that that the actual gas pump was like a kerosene pump to fuel the plane, and that was Roger's actual stop off, and he was a member of Q Branch there to sort of help him out. And then he was sort of in disguise from any of the locals.
That's potentially overthinking the world of Sir Roger Bond a little bit. You know what I mean? I don't think I don't think you have to tie things together quite that tightly.
No.
I certainly just thought he was just an old dude in a petrol station.
I think it loses some of its magic if it is a MI6 guy, because just this random old dude seeing Roger's face and hearing that line, there's more magic to it if he's just a random sort of dude, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. But I mean, for me, one of the best pre-title sequences in the whole series.
Good stuff. Not the best. So here's a question then before we get onto the title sequence.
Yeah.
So this film obviously was like it has some magic for you going back to your childhood. It was a standout movie for you when you was a kid.
Yeah.
Why is that, do you think? Like, why did it come up? Did you watch it at a certain point? Why did this one stand out, do you think, over the other ones?
I was trying to work that out while I was watching it, and I think I was going to sort of say a bit of this at the end, my overall thoughts at the end, but I can say a little bit now. I think there's just so many cool scenes that stay in my memory, like which we'll obviously go through later.
Mm.
But I think the age when I really got into it was the age that film is perhaps suitable for.
Right,
you know,
right.
When I was 6, 7, 8, 9, whatever, maybe it is aimed at a younger audience in terms, you know, obviously not all of it, because some of it is really dark, but, you know, there is a lot of lightheartedness. But it's more the fact I just remember so many scenes from it. I just remember, I could recollect like the whole film when I was super young.
Sweet.
And it always put a smile on my face. And there is something which I mentioned at the end, which is why I think it's
cool. Sort of, sounds good. Yeah. I mean, so the only reason I'm curious is because so many people, this is the butt of so many people's jokes, and I've always known this is like an all-time favorite of yours. Yeah. So it's interesting just to get that.
I think it's like Marmite. You either love it or you hate it.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've always been someone that loves it, but I kind of like the fact that not everyone likes it as well.
Mm. Yeah,
because you'll get people who will only stand by the gritty Bond. Anything outside of that is not good enough or not Bond. And you'll also have people that will be, well, they'll only ever follow the crowd. And if someone doesn't like, if someone says A View to a Killer shit, they wouldn't go near it sort of thing. Even though every Bond film is brilliant in its own right. And everyone, obviously, like we said before, everyone will have a Bond film as their favourite, Die Another Day excluded. But you know what I mean, you know,
do you know what? I'm gonna say just to do that, mention that, I'm turning over a new leaf. I've decided with Die Another Day, I'm turning over a new leaf because I realised every time it comes up, especially because we did the theme tune episode and it was unavoidable. Every time it comes up, we have a little slagging session, and it's been 14 years since I've seen it. It might be brilliant now. I don't know. So
I think it's improved with time.
I am going to not comment on Die Another Day. I'm going to be like, because I was just saying about watching Octopussy, watch it with fresh eyes as if it's the first time you've seen it.
Yeah.
Obviously, take it within the context of the time in which it was made and all the rest of it, and don't compare it to what came before or after, and just take it as a standalone film. I have to apply the same rules to Die Another Day. So I'm gonna now I've got it off my chest about Madonna's song, right? I've got that out there. That's immortalized in the podcast.
Yeah.
I'm turning over a new leaf. I'm gonna approach Die Another Day with fresh eyes when we finally get to it.
That's probably about a year away. So that's a year of not talking about it. But I think
which is probably a good thing. But also which is also like It will be interesting to see if the passage of time has changed my feelings about it. So I'm not going to colour my opinion by constantly slagging it off, because that's not fun. So that's it. New Leaf, turned over. There it is. Bosh.
I like it. New Leaf. There we go. Sounds good. So what did you think of the Octopussy title scene?
I think this is probably the most niptastic title sequence of the entire series. I watched it with the missus, actually, because she'd never seen Octopussy. Oh. And we were both like, damn, there's some titties in this title sequence. Like,
is that how she said it?
She's got a deep voice, deeper than mine. Right. There's some real boobage on display here, and there's, you know, lots of nakedness swinging around. There's one, like, you just see the torso of the woman. She's got this like sort of swimsuit on that's just like basically two thin strips that just cover the nips.
Oh, yeah.
And the rest of the boobage is totally on display, which I find funny. Why is it just the nipples are the naughty bit? You can display the entire boob, but just that one little tweaky bit of nip is the bit that's naughty and rude that you're not allowed to look at.
And it depends, because there's different sizes with different women.
Exactly. So does that mean if they have larger ones, they're more naughty? I don't know.
Or do they just have to cover up more with larger bits of cloth? It's a tough question.
It is a tough one. But I think this is probably the most visually risque title sequence out of the whole series.
You know what? I think I'd go along that, because I was making notes and you know, where you sort of say, oh, bit of nip there or whatever. Yeah.
I mean, I have my entire notepad there of nip times.
Yeah. And I remember seeing naked girl being swung around, seeing naked girl flipping about, seeing naked girl, some amazing close-up boob action with a woman wearing a silver chain, more naked women being fired out of a gun.
The funny thing about that is I'm reading your notes that you sent me before this, and you have actually typed out those full sentences. It does say some amazing close-up boob action with a woman wearing a silver chain, only just covering her nips. The next sentence is brilliant. More naked women being fired out of a gun. Some naked women flipping about. Yeah, brilliant. Love it.
There is a lot of nakedness. Now, in terms of the actual visuals, okay, so the naked women obviously are great. We get a lot of that. Outside of the naked women, we get a couple of neon outlines of Bond. We get a bit of... I don't know if it's just I wasn't concentrating on anything else, but aside from the naked women, I can't remember too much. There was that bit where Bond stand. There's a sort of a still of black and white thing of Bond, and you get the arms wrapping around him, and that's really cool.
That's very memorable, isn't it? Yeah. Like, there are certain title sequences that are super unique, isn't it? Like, Goldfinger is a perfect example.
Yeah.
You can immediately picture that title sequence. Live and Let Die with the flaming skulls and stuff. That's another one. Yeah. And then you've got some that just aren't, like, they're sort of, for want of a better term, more sort of like generic Bond title sequences. Like, For Your Eyes Only would be a perfect example of that. Do you know what I mean? It's just Bond moving around and silhouettes and ladies. Do you know what I mean? And I feel like we get more of the same here. And, you know, if you look at Spectre, for example, when you've got all the tentacles and all that kind of stuff, and GoldenEye, you've got all that sort of imagery of the Soviet Russia and all that kind of stuff that's all super sort of focused on that particular film's plot. And I feel like the only hint to this film's plot you get is that thing you just mentioned, the arms coming round.
With the arms wrapped around, which is pretty cool.
It is cool, yeah. I feel like if they were to make this film today, you'd have had a lot more of the Indian visuals and things like that. Do you know what I mean? Maybe a lot more octopuses
or
something along those lines. I don't know whether that confuses Spectre, but with that kind of stuff. So yes, it's, but not to take away from the ample boobage, because that's always fun.
Without a doubt. There is a lot. Now, obviously, we mentioned about the song in a podcast the other week. And again, I definitely stand by that it is probably the cheesiest, the amount of sax that you get in this song.
Yeah.
But it suits this film so well, doesn't it? It does. Particularly that when it merges in from Roger's last line, like the cheesy Roger face to like the opening of All Time High.
Yeah.
It's seamless, isn't it?
Yeah. It's brilliant, especially obviously something we should also at least reference in this episode is obviously this went head to head with Never Say Never Again, and Never Say Never Again's theme tune, I would say, is cut from a very similar cloth. It's that very cheesy middle of the road sort of pop song, isn't it? You know,
yeah.
And so that must be, you know, the year of 1983. That must have been like the thing to listen to was just that style of music, I guess.
Yeah, and similar, I suppose, For Your Eyes Only a couple of years before similar
sort
of
territory as well. Exactly. So, yeah.
Yeah, interesting. Okay, so post titles, we cut in to what to I absolutely love this scene as well. So this is obviously a set at night. We're in East Germany. Now, for me, this scene is so tense. I think it's great. So we see this clown. We don't know who he is. This clown sort of flipping over a barbed wire fence. And suddenly we see this guy with a blade shining that's chasing him. So they're going through this forest. This clown's obviously like petrified of this knife sort of holding guy. And then his hat gets caught on one branch. And then a balloon pops in another. And you're like, oh, crap. And basically he backs into someone, turns around, and it's a second one. And then we realize there are two of these knife, obviously twins, yeah. Two of these twins with knives, and he gets slashed and he manages to like kick him and sort of hit his way and making his escape. But the setting at night with the forest, with this light moonlight flashing off the knife blades, the fact this guy's a clown, I think it creates intrigue. We don't know what's going on, you know, what the hell is going on, a clown running through a forest at night, what is going on, yeah. Being chased, and then he obviously manages to get out the other side of the forest, but then he gets onto that bridge, they miss with the first knife, but then the second one gets him in the back, floats down a river, and then you see him getting out of this stream, and there's obviously like the ambassador is having a reception party or something, and you see this clown just like sort of fall into the sort of glass door or window or whatever, collapse, and then this egg rolls out. Now, that's the first time you're seeing this film, you're seeing a clown running through a forest at night, being chased by two twin knife throwers, and ending up crashing into this ambassador's thing, holding a jeweled egg. Now, that's I think that's so cool, just because it's like, it makes you want to find out about what's going on next, and it's a pretty shit scary scene as well, I think.
Yeah, well, A, clowns are creepy. That goes without saying. B, it reminds me a bit of the scene where Drax sends the hounds in Moonraker.
Oh, yeah.
And you got that's true. Sort of, you know, that run through the forest. It's a very similar. Yeah. And we said that at the time, that almost looks like a horror film, doesn't it? That sequence. And I would say this is sort of a similar thing. Clowns are creepy. Nighttime running through a forest, two dudes with knives. So this is the first time we see Mishka and Grishka, which I love those names.
Yeah,
I love
it. Brilliant. Mishka and Grishka. The names as well, yeah.
And I will say that kind of, let's look at the previous henchmen from the Bond sort of worlds. We've got Jaws, we've got the Odd Jobs and all those kinds of people. Mishka and Grishka, I feel a little bit unsung in the henchmen world in the sense that A, they're twins, so that's kind of unique. B, that sort of crimson frilly top and waistcoat ensemble they wear, immediately, like, that's the Mishka and Grishka outfit, as far as I'm concerned. And they have all this knife-throwing ability and, like, their circus performance, which is very Flemingy, isn't it? You know, Scaramanga grew up in the circus and all that kind of stuff. Very, very Flemingy, man. And I don't think Mishka and Grishka get the, you know, attention that they deserve.
No, I completely agree. No, definitely. And obviously, they are deadly. Mm. These guys, you know, they're obviously expert knife sort of throwers. And I love seeing them together on screen just because the impact that you get of it.
Yeah.
It's like your Winton Kid, your Bambi and Thumper. You want to see, you know, whenever you see sort of a team, it just adds, doesn't it, to the on-screen impact. And and with those guys, I think they're cool. But I think that's a cool scene, a really cool scene.
It is. A couple of other things that scene is, there's silence in the soundtrack as well. So already pre-title sequence during the jet chase, and during this scene has been silenced as well. And it's like the music doesn't come in again until like the very end when the egg rolls out of his palm and all that kind of stuff. And again, it's like that thing of like the world of Fleming is all very like super luxurious, isn't it? Luxury items was such a huge part of like the Fleming books. Something like a Fabergé egg. Like, have you ever seen a Fabergé egg? No, it's just this sort of thing of like, this just from a world that you just don't see as a normal person. Do you know what I mean? Unless you're some super duper collector or something. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, if it hadn't been for Octopussy, I'd probably have a vague idea, having heard the word Fabergé egg before, but I wouldn't really know what's going on. It's purely down to this film that like, you know, a billion people know what a Fabergé egg is.
Half of my education has been based on what I've learned from Bond films, man. Honestly, I didn't really pay attention at school, so yeah. I know how to say keep going in Greek or whatever it was from Pure
Essence. Cool. So after that, then we get Bond back at MI6, which is always good. Now he goes into Moneypenny's office, but Moneypenny is not the first person he sees.
Mm.
Now,
yes,
what do we think about this scene?
Obviously, we get Penelope Smallbone, who's like, you know, the new young totty in the office. Bond is obviously advancing in years because it's referenced in the scripts. You know, Moneypenny turns around, and I can't remember the line exactly, but Penny, he says about Penelope, she's every bit as lovely, and Moneypenny says, as I used to be. So the age angle is in the script, you know. Bond is, it's not like he's an older guy and he's supposed to be younger. Like, it's referenced in the script that he's an older dude.
It's interesting here because, like we mentioned, so both Lois Maxwell, Roger Moore, getting old, possibly would have been Roger's last film. They both would have bowed out together. This was basically a Moneypenny replacement for the new Bond, should one come in the next film. Now, what would you think if that had taken place, if Moneypenny had been no more and the character that we'd known from 1983 until now was Penelope Smallbone and not Miss Moneypenny? Do you think that would still have had the same impact, even if it was this basically the same character, or what?
Do you know what? I feel like you can't get rid of Moneypenny. Obviously, you can, and not ever in a couple of movies, but I feel like what would have happened there, because obviously if you'd have kept Roger for more films, I feel like the value in that would have been having Penelope Smallbone as like an assistant to Moneypenny, and Bond coming in and flirting with her, and then in turn flirting with Moneypenny based on the fact that he's now flirting with her. And then there'd have been a bit of jealousy there. And you could have had some good vibes going.
That's true. That's really true. They could have used that in A View to a Kill, perhaps.
Indeed.
Obviously, well, they were at the races in that one. But yeah, I think that might have worked. But in terms of the character itself, I totally agree. I think it had to obviously stick with Moneypenny. There's obviously in the novels, is it Luella Ponsonby?
Loelia Ponsonby, yeah.
Loelia Ponsonby, sorry. So I don't know if we'd ever see her or whether they'd use her as a... Obviously, they wouldn't use her as a replacement for Moneypenny, but I don't think there's enough room within the films to bring that character in, potentially. Maybe as a one-off on one film, perhaps.
Yeah,
But if the Penelope Smallbone character had been Loelia Ponsonby, do you think that would have made any difference? And
it's always nice to see a Fleming character. No. Do you know what I mean? It's always nice to throw that in, for sure. Yeah.
It's good. Now, one thing that I love about the scene, obviously, he goes in to see, after giving one rose to Moneypenny and like a whole bunch to Penelope Smallbone, which is quite funny. He goes in to see M. Now, with him is...
Do you think she was named after her father?
Oh, I think she might have been. Poor guy, if that is the case. Poor guy. But yeah,
sorry,
that is a line that he should have used. That is a line that he should have used. So he goes in to see M. Frederick Gray's in there. Now, this other guy, I think he's brilliant. He's the art expert, Jim Fanning. And this guy is just so he's got enthusiasm about his subject. He loves art. Mm. And like the fact that he's being involved in sort of mission, obviously they mention about the egg. M gives Bond a thing about the egg, and he sort of describes it and gets all right and everything. And then M's like, oh, but it's a fake. And Roger's like, okay. And then they're basically saying, but the real one's being auctioned at Sotheby's. And then this Jim Fanning guy's, oh, yeah. You know, you can just see how excited he is to be involved in something like that. And, yeah, I really like that guy. What do you think?
Do you know what I noticed this time around is, obviously, you know, the last time we saw Bernard Leeds M was Moonraker. He wasn't around for Few Eyes Only. They didn't recast the role out of respect for him. We learned, didn't we, that he actually did shoot some scenes, but he was too poorly to kind of really do it, so they cut it out. So this is like it's kind of like the first time you see Robert Brown's M sort of comfortable in it. Do you know what I mean? It's not new. It's not like, oh, here's the new M. It's just like Bond rocks up and there he is. And it's like he was never not there. And it feels like, and seeing Freddie Gray there as well.
Yeah.
And of course we'd seen Robert Brown before anyway, but like it just felt right. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It walks in, it's like he's, you don't replace Bernard Lee, but with the sort of the chit chat in this scene, you know, tell me what you know about Fabergé Eggs 007.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, it's the same thing we've always known and loved, just with a new dude. And I like it, man.
And it's a lot better doing it that way than, oh, 007, the previous M has moved on to another job, and here is a new M sort of thing. Although that has worked brilliantly with Skyfall. I think that's amazing how they did it. I don't think it would have worked had they tried it back then, or at least...
So you know. This is the question, right? Is this Miles Messervy or not? Because
I think I like the idea that it's Admiral Hargreaves. Admiral Malcolm.
Because, I mean, at the end of the day, because you see them in Spy Love Me, don't you? Like, that's when you see Admiral Hargreaves, isn't it? And obviously you've got Bernard Lee's M in that. So it makes sense that Sir Miles was an admiral. So, you know, Sir Miles, like, not that it's actively referenced, it just says M's away in Moonraker, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It makes sense that there he is. But Admiral Hargreaves... Surely his name has to begin with M if he's going to be M.
Yeah, his first name.
What is his first name? Mickey?
Malcolm, isn't it? Malcolm Hargreaves.
Is it?
Wait.
Oh, I know. The way you delivered that, I thought you actually knew what his first name was. And I was like, oh, all right. Yeah, well, that's fair enough.
Well, maybe it is. We don't know. But I kind of like the idea that it's that guy that got promoted.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's cool. But we hear two really good lines in this scene as well. One... Operation Trove. So we've had, you know, we're Operation Thunderbolt, we've had Operation Undertow, we had in the previous film Operation Trove. I like these names, these missions, and when they have Operation something like, I'd like to see that in a future Bond film. Like,
I would
here we are, 007 Operation whatever, and just hearing those words you'd be like,
oh, with the For Your Eyes Only stamp on the folder. Yeah
definitely, that'd be lovely. Awesome. So we get that, and also at the very end we get A Property of a Lady, obviously a Fleming title, which is great, and they've used that kind of like the Hildebrand rarity, the antique place in Spectre. Obviously, it wasn't
sort the of safe house, properly,
but we get that little insight, and I like that, and obviously we get that in this in
me too. Well. Yeah, a little nod to keep the fans happy. Yeah, that's what that is. Nice stuff. Exactly. So. I tell you what else I like about this, man. Obviously, we cut to the next scene, which is like the KGB war room.
Yeah.
I've sat in one of those chairs, actually, when the James Bond... Yeah, years ago, there was... You must have gone to it. Like, I was probably what? It was 1997, because I remember Zero Minus Ten had just come out, or maybe 98. And it was the James Bond exhibition was traveling all over the country. Did you go to that?
I went to one in Bradford Museum. Which was around that time.
Because this was like a travelling one. I remember it was at Portsmouth for like a while, and then it moved on to somewhere else. And they had two of the Octopussy KGB war room chairs.
I wasn't there.
And they had like the map on the wall and stuff. I remember seeing one. I've got some back in the
day.
Have
you got pictures?
Back in the day when you actually had to print your photos out. I don't have them digitally, but I've got them in storage somewhere of me sitting on one of those Octopussy chairs. I have to try and dig it out. But anyway, I digress. But that did raise a smile when this scene happened. I was like, I wonder which one of those chairs it was I sat on.
But this particular scene, I think, like the set is, although obviously we know Ken Adam finished with Moonraker.
Yeah.
This is very got a bit of the Ken Adam-esque style to it, isn't it? We obviously Peter Lamont production designed Octopussy, but you've got the massive map on the wall. All the main villains or baddies, you've got to have a big map of the world, haven't you?
Yeah.
So you've got the massive map. In fact, you've got two, because you've got the big map, and then you've got the little screen that he does his, Orlov does his little talk, and Russia's in red, obviously. You've got the big picture of Lenin. I like the fact that it's sort of that curved table, and they're all sort of sitting behind. Really nice start. You've got the moving floor, and just that whole setup, I think, is great.
I would say, man, like, that is a classic villainous Bond meeting room, isn't it? It really is. Yeah. I mean, it's not a million miles away from what I imagine you would have got if Ken Adam had worked on the film. You know, it's a cool little setting for sure.
Did you spot Mickey G's first cameo?
No, I didn't. I spotted him later, but I didn't spot him in this one. No. Is this the only time he does two in one film?
I think there are a couple where he does two. Sometimes you might hear a voice, and sometimes no. He's definitely done a more. I think he did a couple in Moonraker, or a few others anyway. But this one is very hard. So you know when you see sort of the wide shot of them all sitting around the curved table, he's the one on the far left. So closest to camera on the far left. But obviously he's look. You don't get full sort of frontal face shot of him. He's sort of side on. You see the beard and the glasses.
I'm thankful you don't get a full frontal.
Yeah. I knew as soon as I said that. I know. Yeah. Poor Michael G. Wilson. So yeah. So he's there. So that's cool. He's obviously got his first little cameo there. Now, so this is the scene. Obviously, we get all off. We see Gogol. We know him. We get that sort of Leonard Brezhnev type lookalike character, you know, the sort of communist sort of leader, and then we meet Orlov. Now, what do you think? Because I have heard some people think, this is where he says like his attack strategies on the new computer. We're basically going to invade, you know, go through Czechoslovakia and invade West Germany with our, you know, five tank divisions and 22 tank divisions from Russia or whatever, lightning thrust and all this. Do you think his character is a little too over the top, or do you think that's great, that's how it should be, a crazed general, bang up? What do you think?
Well, first of all, it's the 80s. Height of the Cold War, isn't it? Right up there. You've got, when you think back to the movies of this period, the Russians were always the villain in this particular decade, wasn't it? You know, the Rambo movies, the Russians and all that kind of stuff, and, you know, the Russians were the bad guys. And what I also like is the fact that it's before the Berlin Wall came down, so Germany is still divided, which is a very interesting time in the world of spying, isn't it? Because you've got this division, literally this wall separating Berlin, and all the kind of sneakiness involved in crossing over that border, and, you know, no man's land in between, and people getting shot trying to escape from one side to the other, and defections and all that kind of stuff, which is really exciting, isn't it? And I kind of like seeing this scene, and you've got this nutter general who is kind of like at one end of the spectrum. I imagine if that is the Soviet military meeting room, and they're like trying to work out, you know, what should we do next? Like, what's our next plan? And you've got Gogol on the left, who's the voice of reason. And then you've got Orlov on the right, who's the out and out lunatic. I feel like they balance each other out a little bit, you know?
Definitely.
But in the way they reference Orlov, like people saying he's too over the top, in the way they talk about me in the film, kind of like feels like they think that too in the film. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's like, that's just who he is.
That's his character, definitely. Yeah. But I like, you know, you mentioned basically the Russians are the baddies or whatever. And obviously they were in your Rambos. It was like Russia. But the way, the good things about the Bond films that Eon always did, were they were never overly sort of political in terms of being anti something rather. Like, obviously Russia, we see Gogol, we see the sort of the secretary, the committee secretary guy, and they are, you know, they come across as good people. They don't want to fight, you know, they seem like, so Russia isn't the bad person. It's this crazy,
this sort of like
guy.
Maverick,
so,
within that sort of institution.
Exactly, yeah. And Bond's always been good at doing that, you know.
But that's
which, quite
that's,
diplomatic, which is
that's
good.
It. That like in terms of like, you would have bad guys from various places, but usually they would work for Spectre or something else, do you know what I mean, rather than their government. So it's they've stayed sort of politically neutral over the years, in a sense,
which is good.
On watching this scene, Chris, I had a little thought, and I thought, I wonder what Chris thinks about this. Do you think having General Orlov, right, if we were to just scrub General Orlov, or maybe get somebody else to play General Orlov for five minutes,
right,
do you think we missed out on a really solid Ernst Stavro Blofeld in Stephen Berkoff?
Ooh. You would know how he'd play it, wouldn't you?
You do. You would,
know,
didn't you? Yeah.
You would know exactly what sort of Blofeld you'd get with him. And I really, that's interesting, because I don't think we've had one quite like that, have we?
I imagine he would be a calmer Orlov. Do you know what I mean? He'd be a fucking lunatic, crazy man. Yeah. But he would be one of those that appears calm all the time, and then he'd just flip out all of a sudden. Yeah.
Exactly, yeah. There'd be one or two scenes where you'd just see him go mental at someone, or, you know, whatever.
Like,
and you know,
like matey in Star Wars The Force Awakens, when he freaks out like that. Do you know what I mean? What's his name?
Yeah, yeah.
Kylo Ren, when he starts slicing up everything with his lightsaber. I imagine that's what Berkoff's Blofeld would have been like. Yeah,
that's interesting. Yeah, it's a good what if.
He's got the look to him, man. I can see him with the pussycat. Yeah,
I'm sure he must have parodied it at some point. I don't know what. I'm sure I can just picture him so easily doing that sort of thing. But yeah, good shout, good point. So interesting. So after that, then, so Orlov then visits the Kremlin National Fine Art Repository, and we meet Lenkin. Now he's like a forger that's working for him. So basically, what they're doing.
Do you recognise Lenkin at all, Chris?
I believe I might do. I believe it might have been one of your questions at one point.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, and I'd forgotten about that until I see it. Lenkin is obviously the dude in Living Daylights with the pig sequence with the boobies and all the lights going off. That's the same dude, isn't it?
It's good booby action in that as well. So this one now, basically, so he's what they're doing is they're stealing the gems from the Russian sort of depository or whatever. Getting them to him so he can make fakes and then going to replace them so they can steal the real ones. Mm. Now, he gets told that the real egg, the Fabergé egg, was stolen. And obviously, they find out that the egg was recovered, but the thief was dealt with, but the egg was lost in the river. So they need a new one to create a new forgery. Mm. Now, the only thing about this scene, which I do not understand, is we only get one out of Mishka and Grishka. And I don't know why there isn't the other one there. Maybe he was ill during filming or couldn't make it, whatever. But it would, for me, it just would have been nice if
which one is there. Is it Mishka or Grishka?
Well, this is it. We'll have to find out.
Yeah.
I'm not sure myself. I didn't look into it in that much detail. But it's a bit of a shame. It's only a small thing. But so basically, they know they have to get the genuine egg back. No matter what happens, they have to get it back. And that leads into another absolutely brilliant scene.
Yes. Now, the Sotheby's scene. What I said earlier on about there being some real solid Fleming-esque stuff going on, which you wouldn't ordinarily think from a film like Octopussy. But this whole sequence, I adore it, man. Like, you've got the sort of, what's the word I'm looking for? Like, the upscale nature of what Sotheby's is. Opulence and, yeah, all that kind of stuff. So you've got Bond sitting in there with Jim Fanning, you know, the auction's about to start. We see Magda walk in looking
now there is fine. A lady.
Absolutely good stuff. You see Kumar Khan for the first time. Yeah. And you just know as soon as you look at that dude that he's a baddie, don't you? Like he's just got that look about him, isn't he?
Yes. He looks, I've always thought he looked quite serpentine like, a bit snakeish. Mm, the way that his skin's a bit sort of it's tough and wrinkled, and then his eyes. He does look a bit snake-like. I think if they made Harry Potter back then, he would have been like the Lord Voldemort sort of thing.
I've never seen Harry Potter, so
have you not?
No, so I wouldn't know what that means. But I guess it means he would be a baddie. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Now, I tell you what I love about this, right? Oh, my God. We've had... In the last few films, Bond goes rogue every time, basically, you know, which a lot of people have said, and I must say, I probably agree, is that, you know, every time M says, you can't do this 007, and then Bond just goes and does it anyway, sometimes M goes, right, let's get Bond back in, he's been naughty, let's go and get him, and all that kind of stuff, and he's gone rogue. What I like about this is you get that side of Bond where he's not playing by the rules. He's taking an unbelievable risk by bidding on this egg. Yet, obviously, it works out well. An unbelievable risk. Yet, it's not this huge overt thing. Like, he gets away with it. And I like it. I like it so much. And there's that thing of, like, how shocked Jim Fanning looks when the camera pulls back and you just see Roger there, like, with, you know.
Have you gone mad?
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, let's see how much he wants it. And then that bidding back and forth. It's just so brilliant. And that's like something straight out of the Fleming book, man. It's like that sort of tension. Yet, obviously, Roger does it with a little bit of a playful edge to it because it's Sir Roger. But I fucking love that scene, man. And having the balls to sit there and bid on something like that. And that whole thing of like being sat across from Kumar Khan. And there's just sort of like eyeballing each other. And like you can see every time Kamal's lifting his thing up to bid, he's thinking, you fucking... Do you know what I mean? I love it. I love it so much.
Yeah. I think the thing about Kamal Khan is he's so good at looking pissed off at Bond.
Yeah.
which happens a lot in this film for obvious reasons, but you just got to love the way that happens. Mm. And straight away you're setting up the Bond versus the villain. You know, this is the first time we've introduced him, and it's not like they've got guns pointing at each other. You know, it's a battle of wits and a battle of sort of, well, trying to outbid on this egg. And as soon as he knows, as soon as he gets the info from Fanning about this Kamal Khan, oh, that's interesting, you know, he's bidding on this. And then, he, you know, Bond knows that he has to have it. There's something dodgy going on and he has to find out why. And like you said, the moment he starts bidding is brilliant. And then not only that, he's actually got the real one on him and he asks them to come up, you know, let's have a little look at the egg, passes the egg underneath the sort of booklet, comes back up. Yes, I'll bid another one. And I love the fact that Khan is just like, and you hear all the audience go, you know, it's gone crazy money. And then obviously Khan goes £500,000. And you know, that's a nice round figure as well, isn't it? Yeah. And obviously Bond sort of just shakes his head and Fanning's having like a heart attack next to him. It's just a great scene. It's classy. It's clever. It's funny. And it's Fleming-esque. It's very, very good.
Yeah.
Very good scene.
What is like the icing on the cake is obviously in the next scene when he's back at MI6 and, you know, you've got that whole thing of M being pissed off that he's bid on it and stuff. But then he's like, well, I've got the real one here. Do you know what I mean? It's just he's just got such a massive pair of balls in this film. I love him for it. Do you know what I mean? I love him for it.
And it's so good that switch then, like you said, like, so I think they go outside. We see Gobinder by the stretch merc. You know, Kamal Khan is like this, obviously, he's a super rich sort of dude. But he goes back to CM. And like you said, straight away, he's like having a go at Bond. He's pissed off. You know, you had no business bidding for the egg, Dolism, and what have you. And then finds out what happened. And then he's like, oh, okay. Well, finds out they've gone to Delhi. Yeah, be on the next flight. And the fact that Bond has already booked the next flight, he has 55 minutes to catch it. And he knew that was going to be the outcome. He knew that M was going to have a go at him. He knew M was going to be pissed off. But he knew that here's a real egg. Here's my flight ticket. And that's how it's going to go.
That's
and
it.
Then you see M with like a nice wry smile. He knows this is his best agent.
Yeah.
He can be pissed off with him at times, but he knows that at the end of the day, Bond is the man. And like
what I feel this totally illustrates is that whole thing of going back to Thunderball where, you know, there's that dude who's like, you couldn't have seen him at Troublons, blah, 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 blah. And M's like, if 007 says he saw him, that's enough grounds to investigate. And it's like, yes, man, I love to see M stand up for Bond and like have that faith in him. And it's a similar sort of thing here whereby, you know, like in The Man with the Golden Gun, where Bond sort of goes on leave to go and find Scaramanga. And he's like, and he just says that line and M's like, well, it would, wouldn't you say? Like, no, he says, so suppose I said I found Scaramanga first, you know, that would give me the edge or whatever it is he says. And
yes,
and it's I suppose it would, wouldn't you say? And there's just that unspoken thing of like, okay, sometimes you have to play around the rules a little bit. And like, this is one of those where he's like, don't let him step right out of line. And then Bond has everything under control. He's thought of everything. Yeah. He's one step ahead, everything, every way. And then M's sitting and he's like, damn, man, he's good. And that's what that smile, like, that smile says to me. I love it. And that's what I love about this, man. Like, you can sit here and slag off Octopussy for the clown suit or the fact that Roger's advancing in years or whatever, but there's no getting away from Bond being cool as fuck in this film.
Yeah. That's why I love it so much. I think that's partly why it's right up there for me with scenes like that. Okay, so next we get a lovely bit of sort of cool music when Bond arrives in Delhi. You know, sort of we obviously see him arrive by helicopter on the river. Lovely bit of music, and then it gets taken by a boat to the riverside. Now this is where we meet Vijay. Now I love this bit. I love the fact that Bond's walking around and suddenly this snake charmer starts playing the James Bond theme. Now in the way that I've always seen it is, James Bond, the film series, is not known by James Bond in the films because how can it be? And this is clearly just a little motif that Q has arranged that this is the code music. If you hear this 007, this is the guy that you've got to go and speak to. So it's pre-arranged. So I've always thought of it as that. I've never thought of it as being silly, tacky, this is the James Bond thing. All I thought of all in the James Bond world, this is just a little music motif that Q has told 007, if you hear that, that's your man. So he hears the James Bond theme, goes over, and then they've got their little code phrase, you do take English money, only gold sovereigns. Now that's a nice little link back to From Russia
can
as
I
well.
Borrow a match? Yeah.
Yeah. But also with the gold sovereigns in the briefcase. So there's a couple of links. And I love to, I love that bit. So what are your, what's your opinion on the whole music theme?
Do you know what? I hadn't thought of that. I just thought this is another one of those kind of, you know, Roger moments, like a wink to the camera kind of thing. But in a sense, what you've done there is you've weaved it into the script, whereby the fact that he's playing the James Bond theme is almost like the opening part of their code. So the James Bond theme is like, oh, there it is. Now I say my line about, you know, you do take English money. The response is only gold sovereigns. We're on the same page. Wicked. This is my man. Interesting. Do you think that's actually what they had in mind? Or do you think it's just a wink to the camera?
No, I'm going to go with it. I'm sure that's what they had in mind. Yeah, that's always, I've literally always thought that, and I think that it's a nicer way of thinking about it as well. I think
absolutely,
cool. And it works. So yeah,
good stuff. Do you think they could bring that back in Bond 25 potentially?
What, a James Bond music theme or a code word for us? I'm not sure. There's interesting ways that you can do it, like that one with the snake charm, I think is cool. There's a bit License to Kill with the tank chase where you hear it in bullet fire.
Yeah.
Intriguing, clever ways of bringing stuff back in like that, I think could definitely be done. I don't know how, but somewhat thing like that. So that's quite cool. And then we meet Sadruddin, who's like the head of Station I, who looks suspiciously like the dude that worked in Max Kalber's Java Club. Very, very similar.
That's Disney. Yes. He does indeed. I hadn't spotted that, yeah.
Yeah, so that's quite cool. Basically, they get in the back of the tuk-tuk and they go to see the Monsoon Palace from the distance. Again, quite Fleming, you know, super rich villain, has this massive palace on top of a hill, which is great. Vijay informs Bond that Kamal Khan, you know, he plays cricket, tennis with you know, Vijay's part of it as well. But obviously, backgammon is a big thing and he comes to the club and basically, you know, they plan to meet later on at the club. And then they finish the line with, oh, here's your asp, and Bond hands back the instrument. And it cuts straight from him saying, here's your asp, to a woman's ass just walking in front of the camera. And I think that's a bit of Roger and John Glenn going to each other. Yeah, this will be quite cool.
I like that.
Yeah, which is quite good. And then we cut to the hotel scene. You get so many good Roger lines here. So, as usual, it's just bikini-clad women everywhere, as you used to get in 1983, which was quite a good time for it, I hear. Bond sort of rocks up to the reception, and the guy's like, oh, I hope you have a good time, and he eyes up a woman, oh, I'm sure I will, and gets taken to his hotel room. If there's anything you'd like, sir, anything at all? And what does he say? Remember? He's like,
oh, no, what is it, he says?
He's like, maybe later. But the look that he gives her is there's so much Roger, like, facial cheese in this film, which I love.
Yeah.
So that's really cool. And then he hears sort of, he looks outside his hotel room and then he sees the barge with the Octopussy flag and sees Magda walking onto the barge. So he knows there's a little link there.
Mm.
So it's basically him setting up shop and stuff. And that's all cool. And then we cut to the casino scene. Now, what do you think of the casino scene?
Now, I've got to be honest with you, Chris. This is one of my favourite Bond moments in the whole series. I love it, man. I'm just going to take you through it.
Why are you doing that?
I'm just like getting my eyes ready, right?
Right.
I don't know why I need to get my eyes ready, but there you go. A, he's wearing the white dinner jacket. Always appreciated. Rocking it. Nicely done. Now, what we have here is a classic example of a Bond villain cheating at a game. So, you know, another Fleming thing. You know, we see this all the time, whether it's Drax cheating at cards, is bridge, isn't it? Drax cheats at,
yeah,
is that
bridge,
right?
Yeah,
bridge,
right,
whether
yeah.
it's Goldfinger cheating at gin, whatever it is, they like to cheat. And then we see it with Kamal Khan. This time, obviously, it's with dice and backgammon and all that kind of stuff, which is a link to Cubby because he used to like to play backgammon with Roger, didn't he? What I love about this is he's scoping out Kamal Khan. He's watching the game and the guy's, you know, he's like, should we double or nothing or whatever? And the guy's just being taken to the cleaners time again. I must say, I feel like the dude's a little bit naive that he's like, always a double six when you need it. How do you do it? Yeah. And he's like, it's all in the mist. And it's like, you would want to have a little investigate on those dice, but we'll let you on. Now, what I love about this is, and it's a similar thing from the auction, is where Bond's on the trail of somebody and he just gets in there and just pokes them to get a reaction. Do you know what I mean? And just and that's something he does all the time. And I love this. He sits down.
Roger.
That's it. Yeah, he sits down across from him. You know, it's the equivalent of Bancoing at a casino, and he sticks the Fabergé egg right down there as collateral for the game. And it's like, if you're going to get a dude's attention, A, make him bid $500,000 for this thing in the first place, and then show up down the light road and stick it in front of his face, man. Like, again, gigantic testicles from Sir Roger there. I love it. Now, what I love about this more than anything else is, you know, they're playing the game or whatever, and then Bond's like, well, you know, player's privilege. I would like to just use your lucky dice. Something about the sound of them rolling the dice in that little cup pleases me. It's such a pleasing sound. Like, I can't even remotely do the sound. But like the way that the dice rolls, I could listen to that all day long. It's so pleasing. Yeah. Anyway, it's like diggy, 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 diggy.
Yeah.
Rolls the dice, and he locks his eyes on him, on Kamal. And he doesn't even look down, and he's like, you hear the gasp, and he's like, double sixes, fancy man. And he doesn't even look down. And it's like, ah, you put me in that situation, I would have to just quickly glance down and check, because I would just be nervous that it wouldn't be a double six. He doesn't even look down, Chris. And like, that to me is one of the coolest moments in the whole series of all the Bond films, man. I love it so much.
Yeah, I mean, for me too, it's amazing. I love the fact as well that Khan, as soon as Bond, you know, he kind of like, of course, you could only win with a double six. And it's like, as soon as Bond picks up his dice, he's like, you bastard.
Yeah.
You absolute bastard. And he can't do anything about it. And the look of detest on his face as Bond is just like,
because this is the second time he's publicly screwed him over in front of everybody and really stuck a spanner in his works, man. Love it. Yeah.
And obviously, he throws it, and then Khan's face is just fantastic. And then we get a couple of good one liners. In fact, prior to that, it was quite good when he goes up to the bar and Magda's there, and she's like, oh, you have a good memory for faces and figures. And that's quite nice, isn't it? And then he obviously come back. But the way that he's so cocky, but in a good way, you know, with the egg and everything. And Khan's got his checkbook ready to go. And then there's that brilliant line, spend the money quickly, Mr. Bond.
Yeah, I love it, man. I intend to, Kamal Khan. I love the way he says Mr. Bond. I love the way Kamal Khan speaks all around. He's got a brilliant voice, man. Mr. Bond, later on he's like, Octopussy, Octopussy. Just the way he talks, I want to listen to that man speak. You know what I mean?
He's got a really good movement as well. If you ever watch the way he walks, it's just class and elegance.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether that's how Louis Jourdan walks normally. I'm assuming he brought that into the character, but it's subtle. It's something that you wouldn't normally think about, but it adds to the character immeasurably. And he, like the way that, like you said, the way he talks, the way he walks, he just is class. He is pure class. But that seems great. So obviously he's done him out of, was it 200,000 rupees? Do you have the cash? And then obviously, and I love the fact that his checkbook is massive. It's like a foot long. and the guy's just ready for it. Yeah. It's like, here's your checkbook.
He just puts his hand out, doesn't he? Like that. Yeah. And then the checkbook just gets placed in his hand with the pen, man. Love that stuff. Yeah.
That's quite cool. Yeah. And then obviously he writes it out and spend the money quickly. And then we get the odd job with the golf ball moment with Gobinder. Here's my security and yours. And then obviously Gobinder takes the dice and you hear crack, you know, crack, crack, crack. And then it sort of see all the little dust.
Yeah.
And again, I think that's great. I think that's brilliant. It is obviously, the equivalent of the odd job golf ball moment. But I think it's brilliant.
Again, that's easily a moment where you could just go like, oh, you know what I mean? And roll your eyes at it. But of course it's exaggerated. Do you know what I mean? You know, but it's part of the fun, man. You know what I mean? You can't like, just sort of poo-poo all these moments because part of the fun. I think, like I said earlier, I think the mistake comes of judging this alongside a Casino Royale or something like that, or a Skyfall or whatever, and just poo-pooing it because of that. And it's fun, man, at the end of the day. It's fun. It's brilliant. It's cool. Love it.
You know what? Going back to your question before we started this, why do I like it so much? And I think it is because it's probably the funnest Bond film for me personally.
Yeah, yeah.
I just... am smiling literally throughout the whole film, and I think that's why I've always digged it, and I've always like thought it was brilliant. But
very nice.
Yeah, there we go. Now, what do you think about this line? Probably the most racist line in the entire series, or at least potentially, when Bond gets his winnings and he gives some to Vijay, and then he gives a wad of cash to Sadruddin, and he says, "There you go, and keep you in curry for a few weeks, won't it?" And I hear a lot of people have a go at that line. But what do you think?
I would say this is a very, very delicate topic, man, right? But I would say that's perhaps a little bit on the oversensitive side. And for example, right, let's flip it around. Some dude hands me a stack of cash and says, you know, that'll keep you in tea bags for a few weeks, won't it? I'd be like, do you know what? Fair enough. I have about 10 cups of tea a day. Yeah, brilliant. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So is that a racist statement? I feel like you could make it one if you interpreted it in a certain way, but then that's on you for interpreting like that, surely.
And also, the fact that he's speaking to kind of like a fellow agent who knows all about it, it's different to saying that to someone in the street, a random beggar, where it could be seen as potentially more racist, but he's part of the crew. He knows what's going on. And it's like just looking after the money. It's just Bond saying sort of a joke. And he's, you know,
And so I mean, at the end of the day, if you go to India, that's they eat curry there. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, is that, I'm not sure. Again, this is a very, very sensitive topic. I can feel the listeners bubbling up already. So, but I don't know if that is just somebody being overly sensitive or not, but maybe because I haven't ever been the victim of that kind of thing, I don't know whether I'm just not getting something there or not. So I don't know.
Can I admit to something?
Go on, Ian. You're massively racist and you hate anybody.
I'm a huge racist. No. So basically, literally, I was watching obviously this film. That scene came up, and I before it cut to the next part, I paused it. I got on the phone and I ordered an Indian curry from a local takeaway.
I love it, man. I can just imagine you sitting there watching it and be like, yeah, actually, that sounds nice. Pause. Have one of those, please. Yeah.
I literally got my nice lamb pathia and Peshwari naan delivered for that evening, so that was good.
Very nice.
So great, great casino scene. That very Roger-like, but great. Now, so he goes outside, and Gobbledor's waiting for him. So Gobbledor's in one of the tuk-tuks. He's got his big blunderbuss, which is, I like with Octopussy, the type of weapons you see, you don't see in any other sort of Bond film.
Do you know what,
there
man?
Are so yeah. many cool weapons.
I was going to say about this. This is like quite visually pleasing, this film. There's a lot to look at in this film.
Yeah.
And it does like stand on its own a little bit in terms of the visuals. Like, Gobinda is a very striking henchman. Like, he's a very handsome dude as well, actually. He's not like your typical ugly henchman. He's like a very strikingly, very strong jaw, a very handsome dude. Obviously big and, you know, a burly geezer. But there's, I almost feel like, I get the feeling of this, like this sequence in particular, and it's similar sort of time as well, is like the whole Indiana Jones films. Do you know what I mean? Those sequences where they're chasing through like some bazaar in the middle of somewhere, and you know, there's dudes with those big curved swords and all that kind of stuff, man. It's exciting. I like it.
Yeah, I do. I think that's all. It adds to the sort of exoticness of it all. I think that sort of thing, isn't it? Which is cool. So he obviously starts to chase Bond and Vijay, and Bond's like, Vijay, we have company. And then it's obviously this super rare tuk-tuk that he sort of wheels down the road, which is really cool. They sort of go down the steps, you know, step on it and all this sort of stuff. And then you get a sort of a jeep that they clash with, and there's a group of thugs. And again, these crazy weapons, some with like loads of different blades. There is that star blade. There's a guy that jumps on Bond, and it's like a star dagger type thing, and he gets it. And it sort of goes through Bond's chest pocket, and you're like, oh, shit. And then obviously Bond punches him away, pulls it out. And when Bond chucks it, he chucks it at the guys in the Jeep, and they all duck. And it lands in this post pretty close to, like, some of the locals. So that's a bit sketchy. You know, Bond could have probably done one of them in. Yeah. And then he obviously sees that it was a wad of notes that saved him, and he chucks that, and it lands in some guy's sort of money pot who's rattling something for a... making a bit of music or something, which is quite cool. Now, what do you think about this whole sort of chase action scene, this bit here?
Well, it's a classic example of Bond in an unusual vehicle, or like a lot of the time we see Bond in a vehicle and he's either outclassed or he's against a vehicle that's much more powerful. Motorbike versus helicopter, for example, in Tomorrow Never Dies. You know, bobsleigh versus motorbikes or whatever it is, like, in Furious Only, things like that. So Bond in a tuk-tuk, it doesn't scream the most Bondian vehicle in the world. And it is a funny chase, isn't it? There's a lot that goes on in this. This goes for laughs rather than a serious chase. This is like the Spectre car chase as opposed to the Quantum car chase. Do you know
exactly.
what I mean?
Exactly. Definitely.
And you get some, you know, obviously VJ was a famous tennis player. You get him fending off the bad dudes with the tennis racket and game, set, and match and all that kind of stuff, which again, you could roll your eyes at it and be like, oh, this is just ridiculously stupid, which, you know, if you're going to compare it to Fleming, it is. But, you know, it's fun at the same time. So, yeah, it's a fun chase. There's a lot going on. I like the rupee bit. You know, that's nice. And yeah, it's a fun chase, man. I like it.
And there's a bit where the tuk-tuk launches over the camel. And I know one or two people aren't too happy about that. But, you know, like you said, it is just part of it. I think you just got to go with it. So they get away. Oh, there is that cool bit where they're fighting the Jeep and the cyclist comes through the middle of them. And that wasn't planned. And that was actually just some random Indian cyclist dude that happened to go along, as if that's what happens every day.
Yeah.
Which is pretty cool. But there's a part where obviously they clear the camel, and then Gobinder tries to shoot Bond. Bond gets out of the way and misses. And then it goes into a bit of a foot chase where they're in this sort of bizarre market type thing. And again, we get the firewalker, we get the man sleeping on the bed of nails, we get a sword swallower, and then we get all the sort of thugs with their sort of crazy weapons as well. And there's some cool little battles here where Bond takes a sword out the sword swallower's mouth, and then one guy, you know, swipes one guy who sort of falls back onto the fire. And then there's another bit where he sort of kicks some oil into the fire and that goes up and what have you. So what do you think about all that?
Do you know what? That particular sequence with the sword fight is the Indiana Jones sequence for me. Do you know what I mean? It's like that could have almost been lifted from Indy straight away, I think.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, I like it's a visually exciting chase. There's a lot to look at. There's a lot going on. And of course, the end part when they drive straight through the paper wall that immediately covers itself over again. Yeah. That's a cool thing. Like that reminds me a little bit of the Batcave. Do you know what I mean? When you drive the Batmobile and all of a sudden the rock would just fall down, and then like that's it. It's all good. It's nice. Yeah.
And then Gobinder and the other guys don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
No, I do like the whole bed of nails and he flips the thug onto it. I thought that was quite a cool bit. And then obviously they go through the advertising, which was into Q's lab. So here we go. We've got Q in the field again. Now, what do you think of this Q's lab scene?
This is very much played for laughs, isn't it? I mean, all of the Q scenes are to some degree, but always good to see Desmond. Love a bit of Desmond. You've got this weird rope thing that comes out with a dude hanging on the top of it, and then it falls over and you get like that weird sound, and it's having problems keeping it up, Q, and all that
experimental
kind of
model 007.
Yeah, all sorts of stuff going on. You've got that little camera thing that he zooms in on the boobies and stuff. Yeah. So we're in proper, like, you know, carry-on film sort of humor at this point, aren't we?
Yeah. Is that too much or not?
I dare say, like, with this film, I think you've got... I don't know whether I should save this to the end, but, like, you've ultimately got a film here that could be a serious thriller, right? As serious as a James Bond thriller would ever get. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? You could have that. But you've also... I just set Siri off all of a sudden. Let me turn that off. You could have like a serious movie and it's peppered with a lot of comedy. And I think if you took that out, you could have had like a harder-edged kind of Bond thriller for this. Yeah. So it just ultimately depends what... You know, like, for example, you take the clown sequence, that's very dark. You could have played the auction sequence very straight. Do you know what I mean? You could have done that with this film.
Yeah.
And I think, obviously, it's Roger, so you're not going to do that. So I think it just means you make a creative choice. Are you going to make this harder edged or not? You could have done that with this plot if you'd wanted to. They didn't want to.
Do you think the reason for that is that obviously Fior Eyes Only was done for gritty and realism, and although it was potentially well received and did okay, do you think the majority of people were like, well, hang on a minute, where were the one-liners? Why where was the humour? Why was Rog not doing his thing? And that's why they brought it back in.
Maybe if there's one thing we've learned from doing this podcast is you cannot please everybody. And it's you know, you make one decision and a load of people enjoy it and the other group don't. And it's like, and if you do either or, you're going to leave somebody unhappy. And I feel like, yeah, maybe like it really was for years, I guess, until Daniel came along. It was Sean versus Roger, wasn't it? It was like when you thought of James Bond, it was like one group was in Sean's corner, one group was in Roger's corner. And that's just what it was. I remember people saying that all the time when I was a kid.
And it was, for non-Bond fans.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, if Roger, and you can't argue with the fact that dude's movie's made an absolute killing. So it's like, maybe that's what the response was. And it was like, you know, we missed that in Fear Eyes Only. Let's bring it back in Octopussy.
Yeah, maybe. We'll never know. But like, it is interesting that you've got a film that has both elements. Because generally speaking, they are either the dark and gritty or the all-out crazy.
Yeah.
And this one does have both sides to the coin.
The score is very dark as well. Yeah. When you listen to that score, man, it's very Living Daylights-y, actually, this score.
That's interesting.
And I feel like you could have put this in, I suppose those last three John Barry scores all have a similar kind of vibe to them. Obviously, like the sounds used in Daylights is a lot different. But in terms of like the moods, I guess, of the music, those last three films, I feel like, have a similar kind of vibe to them.
There's one of the cues, which I'll come to a bit later, which is very similar to One in Daylight. So it's funny you should say that, actually.
And it's like, you don't get things like in The Spy Who Loved Me when they're driving the van through the desert and it's like, you don't get any of that. It's all very dark and a very serious score for what is a lighter-hearted movie.
Yeah, which I think helps. Definitely,
yeah,
without a doubt. I like the bit at the end of the Q Lab scene where Q's basically telling VJ not to let Bond teach any of his bad habits and stuff like that. So I think it's quite a nice byplay. It's all lighthearted.
But yeah, absolutely. Do you know what? Something we should mention. How likable is VJ, man? I fucking love that dude. He's so likable. And I love, he's got such a friendly face. He's one of those people, like, you know, as soon as you meet Karen Bay, you just like him, don't you? And it's the same with Draco. Those kinds of allies that you just warm to immediately. VJ is definitely one of those as well, I'd say.
And he's got to be commended for the chemistry that he and Rog have on screen. You know, he wasn't an actor.
Yeah.
He was a professional tennis player. Obviously, he was an exhibitionist tennis player, so he would, I don't mean he played naked, he basically, you know, he was one that would please a crowd and do lots of tricks and stuff like that, so he did like to play up, but I think he's brilliant in a role. I think he's fantastic, and he is someone that he's just so friendly and warm, like, so sort of, I think he's great, for sure, which is really cool.
He's a good lad.
He is, yeah. So after that then, so Bond then goes back to his hotel and has someone waiting to have dinner with him, and we see...
That's it. Do you know what? I like that sequence where Bond's kind of walking across, and then the waiter runs up to him and kind of catches him, and he's like, oh, okay. And he goes and sits down, and there's Magda waiting for him and stuff, which is kind of cool. I like how, like, so basically Kamal has sent her to do his dirty work, hasn't he, to lure him in, which, if you're going to lure Bond in, send him a beautiful woman, that's for sure. That's going to always... catch the eye. Now, she has a rather interesting vibe to her, doesn't she? Basically, she gets somebody steps up and just takes a photo of him. And that made me think of Dr. No at the beginning. And I thought, oh, that's interesting.
Nice link.
And he kind of looks back at her confused, and she says, it's for my scrapbook. And essentially, though it's not really overtly said, it implies she's got a scrapbook of all of her lovers that she just keeps to sort of look back on in future times, which makes me think, damn, man, she must be absolutely amazing in the bedroom, don't you think?
What I want to know is, how big is that scrapbook?
Exactly. How many pages and pages are we looking at there?
Yeah. Do you know what? This particular scene and the one straight after, Magda is dirty. Mm. You just know she is filthy.
Yeah.
She is.
In a good way.
She knows what she wants and she'll get it. And she's more than happy that her role is to seduce someone and get what they need to from them. She does it for pleasure. She's a bit like Honor Top like that. Mm. Honor Top kills people, obviously, and she enjoys the way that she does it. And although Magda is not, you know, she doesn't kill like that, she definitely enjoys getting more pages on her scrap.
And all the power to her, as far as I'm concerned. Go for it.
Oh, love. Definitely. Yeah. Without a doubt.
Yeah, no judgment from me. Bring it on.
That. Yeah. And it was quite cool, the whole, well, she's basically saying to Bond, you know, Khan suggests a trade, the egg for your life. And Bond's like, oh, the prices of eggs have gone up, but that's, you know, that's a bit much sort of thing. So that's all interesting. And then they basically go to the hotel room, and this is a classic scene that you've seen in millions of movies where, oh, there's a nightie there, or there's a shoe there, and you know, whatever. And obviously
the trail of clothes leading to the bed. Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is great. And her first line is dirty as well. I like it when she's like, oh, I need refilling. And Bond's sort of look that he gives her as well. It is great. It is great. And she knows it. I think she looks brilliant in this particular scene.
We've said this recently, but Magda was never one that really caught my eye. All that, of course, they all do, all Bond girls do, but she was never that high on my list of Bond girls over the years. Now, as I've got older, and of course, we met Christina Weyborn, didn't we? And goodness gracious me, in real life, she is absolutely stunning, I have to say. And I'm keeping my language deliberately neutral there, but you know, like, read between the lines there, ladies and gentlemen. Good Lord. I've become over all peculiar. But now, in my older years, looking back at her in this film, I'm very, her stock is rising, absolutely.
Yeah, without a doubt. Yeah, she's a beauty in this, without a doubt. So, and then she has that nice little word when Roger, like, forgive my curiosity, but what is that?
That's my little octopussy.
I love the way she's
yeah, love it.
It's cool. It's quality.
You couldn't
and
have
nice
had any other well. Bond in Octopussy, could you? You couldn't have had any, if you'd have decided to make this film at a different time, you couldn't have done it, because it was, having the title Octopussy is just, Roger owns that, as far as I'm concerned. Yeah. No other Bond would be allowed to have it.
Yeah, I don't think they could pull it off either. No one. It is pure Rog, which is obviously great. And what I like is, while that is going on, we see Kamal Khan rock up in his Rolls Royce, and I like the registration CAM1, which is obviously a bit like CUB1.
Yeah,
with Cubby's thing, and so you know that he knows a Bond and Magda there. Obviously, it's all been set up anyway. But when sort of Bond wakes up, Magda's not next to him, and she's gone to steal the egg, and he checks his watch, you know, a cool little gadget. Cause back in the Q lab, they put the homing chip in the Fabergé egg, and obviously he was given that fountain pen, which we'll talk about later. So he's tracking the egg with his watch, and he sees that it's moving away, so he knows that Magda's got the egg. So they're about to have they have a little smooch or what have you, and then she goes outside, and she's like, oh, actions speak louder than words. And she's like, oh, you're so right. And as he's about to go in, I love the fact that she just basically backflips or back rolls off the balcony and unfurls her dress.
That's a very striking thing, that little scene. I always remember that sticking in my head as a kid. That is cool.
It's brave, isn't it? Yeah, it is brave, and it's skillful, and it's what I noticed as well was Christina Weyborn did that stunt herself.
Mm.
Like
she was a gymnast, wasn't she? Is that right?
Yes, she was. Yeah. She was a gymnast and an athlete. She was super. She was like an athlete as well. And when you see it unfurl and you see her sort of physique underneath, it's
very impressive, isn't it, Chris? That's something I very much took note of she's wearing essentially like a little bikini at the end, and I very appreciated the little gift we got at the end of her dismount.
Yeah. We didn't. We'll have to send her a thank you note for that. So that was cool. So that was obviously. I just love the fact that, you know, she's been put in by Khan to do a job, seduce Bond, get the egg, and she does it flawlessly, absolutely flawlessly. Gets the egg, hangs the egg to Khan. He puts his jacket over her, and he looks up at Bond's like, I've finally got one over on you, son. And that's quite a cool.
That's
you can
his
see.
First dig back at Bond, isn't it? That's his first dig.
Yeah.
But what makes it even better is he doesn't even realise that he thinks he's got one up on Bond, but he hasn't, because Bond has given him the egg with the little device listening thing in it, and he's got him back, and he's played precisely into Bond's hands, which makes me love it even more.
But Bond turns around and then gets judo chopped himself by Govinder, doesn't he?
Yes, that is true.
And then
true.
He's knocked out. And that obviously I know it because I've seen it a lot, but that's got quite a, it does shock you if you've forgotten it or if you haven't seen it for a while. So that's quite a good impactful scene. So he gets knocked out. And then we see Kamal Khan on his way to see Octopussy's Island. So he's on a barge, it's all women on there doing the rowing and...
In, out.
You could use that as a certain tape for something.
You certainly could. I don't know what, but yeah.
No. Exercise, obviously. but that has to be the best way to travel.
Yes.
A barge full of beautiful women, and you're just like standing around, just sort of, yep, these women are taking me across the water on the barge. It's pretty cool.
Isn't it is nice.
I do like that. So we obviously he gets to the island, which we find out again just women, no other blokes around. So it's a pretty cool place, and I like the fact that the way he walks, he does look like anyone that wants to watch it again. He just looks so stylish. The way he just carries himself when he's walking is great. But obviously he gets sort of these women guards, female guards, take him to see Octopussy. Now this scene is great because. We get lots of cool moments. The fact that we don't see Octopussy's face, like at the start, all we see is the little bit of fish food going down, the fish or the octopus or whatever. We see Kamal Khan. He comes in. He says the egg has been recovered and Octopussy's pissed off that it was stolen in the first place. Now, up until this point, Kamal Khan has been introduced to us as the main villain. You know, him and Bond, head-to-head, main villain. But in this scene, we then hear that, hang on a minute, this main villain has to obey what Octopussy is saying.
And it's like when you see Darth Vader with the Emperor, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. And you get that and you think, well, hang on a minute, who is she then? And then the intrigue around her character, if she's able to have that power over him, who we think is the main villain. And I really like it, and it really builds up the Octopussy character. And I think it's a great scene where he's like, we're going to have to get rid of Bond. And she's like, no. And he's like, a no from you will have very little chance of becoming a yes, therefore.
Octopus.
So it's a really intriguing little thing.
It's almost like when you don't see Blofeld in the early movies, isn't it? It's just like you see her hands doing things, and it's like when you see Blofeld stroking a pussycat or, feeding his fighting fish or whatever. It's a similar thing, isn't it? And she's got this weird pet that happens to be an octopus. Do you know what I mean? It really does. I think that's one of the most powerful things in movies, is when you don't see things. It's like the whole idea of Jaws is like Jaws the shark as opposed to our Jaws. Like, it's infinitely more terrifying when you don't see the shark. Do you know what I mean? It's so much more powerful. And when you do see the shark, you're like, oh, that's a bit lumb. But at this stage of the game, when all of a sudden the plot is going along as you think, okay, Kamal Khan's a bad guy. He's going to get his comeuppance eventually, blah, blah, blah. And then all of a sudden the gear changes and you're like, oh, hold on a minute. There's this whole new level to whatever this story is and who this guy works for. Yeah.
Yeah. It's cool. It just sets it up nicely. And it's a hook, isn't it? It's like... hooks in the audience to find out what goes next. And then we see Bond coming to, so he's been knocked out. He comes to, he's in this room. He doesn't quite know where he is. He does a little bit of scoping around the room, a little bit sneaky, not a huge amount, but, checks out what's going on. And basically the door opens and he's like, dinner, 6 o'clock or whatever it is. And then we see Bond suited and booted in his black dinner jacket and what have you. Now, this scene I think is brilliant as well. The sort of dinner table scene where it's just sheer sort of luxury again. You've got the gourmet meal, you've got everyone dressed up to the nines, and the byplay between Bond and Kamal Khan here, they're almost trying to outcharm each other, and it is just so good. What do you think of this scene?
It is good. It's kind of again, it's that classic scene, isn't it, where Bond gets captured and then he's invited to an opulent dinner with the villain.
Yeah.
You go straight back to Dr. No all the way back to the beginning, and that's you have that scene, don't you, where they're just there's like, for all intents and purposes, overtly, it's this pleasant thing that they're doing, eating all this lovely food, but there's this tone of menace just bubbling beneath the surface the whole time, and like, nobody's actively going to stand up and go, ah, and start a fight, but yeah. It's all like, it's all just hidden underneath this veneer of like, they're pretending to like respect each other or whatever. Underneath, they're just like, they're just waiting to get at each other, which I think is an intriguing device, isn't it? As a thing. And like I say, you go back to Dr. No, and it happens throughout the whole series where you have Bond having dinner with the villain and then them just sort of having like snipey little verbal attacks on each other before it all kicks off.
Yeah, it's really cool, really cool. And I like the fact that obviously Kamal's like, okay, Bond sort of says, well, I don't quite know why I'm here. You've got the egg. And Kamal Khan's like, yeah, but we haven't got all the answers. And then I won't go into too much detail because I might give away my question. But basically, Khan says that he wants to get, you know, he's going to get some answers. And and Bond's, well, you know, what if one doesn't want to talk? You know, supposing I don't want to talk, whatever. And then obviously that happens. But I like, it's just Kamal Khan, the threat is there, like you said, but without...
He's one of those, isn't he, you know, that he's not a physical threat.
No.
But you can tell, like, you wouldn't cross him because he'd be absolutely ruthless in whatever his response would be, wouldn't he? Do you know what I mean? And it's like, you know, he's a smaller dude in terms of stature, but, like, I don't know, there's a real dead-eyed ruthlessness to him that I think that you just wouldn't cross. And of course, he's always got Gobinda stood next to me, that takes care of that side of things as well.
And speaking of Deadeye, what do you think about him plucking out the sheep's eyeball and the sheep's head and everything? That's
and the way he just tucks into it as well. He's just like he's eating.
He loves
egg.
It. Doesn't he?
He loves it. Yeah, it's minging. Again, that's another little Indiana Jones styly thing, isn't it? Temple of Doom that happens in?
That's right. Yeah, Temple of Doom, and that was only the year before, I believe, so or around that sort of same time. I think so. It might have been the same year. But yeah, so I mean, that's a cool scene. And then they basically said until tomorrow then. So Bond goes up and he gets cock blocked by Gobinda, doesn't he? Because he wants to go for a nightcap with Magda and Gobinda. Basically,
as you would. Temple of Doom was 84.
And then he offers Gobinda a night. Yes. Oh, 84. There we go. So it's one after, year after. And then he offers Gobinda a nightcap, which is quite cool. But he likes his nightcaps, does Rog? He offered one to Anya in Spy, doesn't he? Mm. So, likes his sort of, because they normally lead to something, don't they?
That's precisely what I was about to say. Yes, absolutely. The nightcap is a useful device to get to, you know, what he's ultimately interested in.
So what would have happened had Gobinda said, yes, I'll join you for a nightcap?
Well, maybe that would have been his first time that he references in Skyfall.
Ah, there we go. Yeah. See, it all links up. It all links up, doesn't it?
Yeah, like I said, Gobinda is a handsome dude, so.
He is indeed. So there we go. Interesting stuff. Now, obviously, this is where we bring in some of the gadgets. So Bond, he's now in his sort of safari suit. He's obviously changed out of the dinner jacket. He doesn't want to be walking around the palace at night in that. So he's got on his safari suit. So he basically gets the fountain pen, screws the top off, and squeezes the acid onto the metal bars of the window. Pulls them open and goes outside for a little jaunt, a bit like he did in the White House. He went out for a little jaunt on diamonds, isn't he? And here he goes for a little outside sort of walk around the house. Now there are some really cool bits here. First of all, the music. I think the music cue for this bit is brilliant. I absolutely love it. We get the classic John Glenn pigeon scene that sort of frightens him, that comes out, and that's obviously pretty cool. And there's a bit where he just peers into Magda's bedroom and she's just taking off her stockings or whatever. And he gives a good little Rog look. He's like, yes, I could probably look at this for a long time. But you know, I'm on a mission, so I can't. And then the outside lights just blast on. And then obviously we get Orloff arriving in his chopper. So he sort of tries to work out what's going on. I really, really like this scene. And I love the music for this scene. Yeah. What do you think of this
one? I always am in full encouragement when it comes to Bondian sneakiness. I love it. It's one of my favourite things. So it's good to see that here. And him sort of spying on Magda as she's sort of bumbling about in her little room. I like it. It's good stuff. Nice and pervy, which you do get, you expect from Roger, don't you? You know what I mean? Yeah. Raise an eyebrow and all that kind of stuff.
That's it.
But it's good. So basically, we got some sneakiness and then we get this sort of like... sequence where he's listening in on the what's my brain? My brain's shutting down. The listening device. Is that what you call it?
Yeah.
Yes. We
call it a bug.
We'll call it a bug. That's what I was missing. Yes. He's got the bug going on. Magda's turns her hairdryer on so he can't hear things. He just gets little snatches of little things and he just hears like 1 week in Karl Marx start and all that kind of stuff. 1 week from today in Karl Marx start and all that kind of stuff. So we don't get the whole plot revealed to us immediately, or Bond doesn't rather. He gets little snatches. So there's still some mystery there, which is nice, isn't it?
It's good. I think he finds out that there's a load of fake jewelry being made. So he knows that's going on. Which is being put in Orlov's chopper. And obviously it's that little hook that leads to the next thing. I love the fact, what did you think of the fact as well, that he's creeping around going after Gobindu and Orlov and Khan, and Magda just opens the bedroom door, watches him chase, and just like gives him a little, like smiles to herself as in like, yeah, go for it, man. Why not? You know, she's totally not loyal to Kamal Khan, is she?
I don't think she would be. The idea of Magda that I get from her is that she's a seductress through and through, and she has been ploughed by Bond, and so therefore she has a certain affection for him now, a flirtatious affection, and she's looking at that and perhaps thinking, go on, you go for it. You know what I mean? Yeah. Something like that.
I think that's quite cool, actually.
Yeah.
It's quite a good little moment. So inside, so Bond's obviously listening outside, but Khan basically thinks that, you know, this fake egg has caused so much trouble, gets his gun and smashes it. But that's actually obviously the real one that Bond had, and Khan doesn't know it's a fake. And Khan obviously did, and you can see Khan's face is a bit gutted because he obviously wants to keep it. But then he notices the little listening bug. He's like, Bond. Get Bond now, sort of thing.
Kill Bond now!
Yeah. And they obviously go to his room and they find out that he's broken out. Now, Bond, he goes to hide in the cold storage, doesn't he? Because he sneaks in, sees Gobindu walking past, and then there's loads of like meat hanging up, and then he sees like two bodies, obviously. There's someone that, Khan's just not bothered by whatever, kill them and hang them up. So now I quite like this idea. So he gets into the body bag, you know, that like where the bodies were taken out, and basically we have a manhunt, don't we? We have like a tracking hunt, so to speak. So what do you think about the part where those guys in the Jeep are chucking these dead bodies on the back of the Jeep? And first of all, you hear, oof. And they're like, what was that? And then they basically drive around to the fat, to the back of the sort of palace or whatever. And I love the fact that they just get these bodies and they just chuck them and just dump them. And you see loads of skeletons there. So basically, if you cross Khan, that's where you're going to end up. You
know? Yeah,
you're going to end up sort of animal food down in this pit. And they go to pick up Bond and he's like, and then scares him shitless. And then obviously gets out of this thing. I quite like that. I think it's quite cool.
Absolutely. I imagine you might have a fair bit of superstition around that area as well. So it's
that's a good point. Yeah.
By doing that, it scares them off. It gives them enough time to kind of untie the sack and do a runner. Now this is a sequence, isn't it? Whereby I feel like there's going to be a lot of people who don't like it. So I'm going to lay it all down, right? So basically he climbs out of the sack. We've got Khan on the back of his elephant. Ah, God, let the sport commence. Love how he speaks, right?
And then that big horn as well.
Yeah. And then so we get Bond in full-on safari mode running through the jungle. Now what we have here is all the bad dudes on elephants and running around trying to find him and all the rest of it. Bond sort of like running through the bushes, hiding and, you know, all the rest of it. And we get, he encounters several little challenges as he goes. So for example, like the first one, he runs into that like spider's web and like gets them all off him and, you know, squidges one against his elbow and stuff. Then we have a tiger that turns around and growls at him, to which Bond goes, sit. And then the tiger just buggers off.
Yeah,
how do we feel about that?
I don't mind that. I mean, I know.
I knew you'd fucking love it.
No, I know people hate it, and there is actually one thing in this particular scene which I could probably go without.
Yeah,
which we'll get to in a moment. But the whole, fuck it, it's Rog. Rog has got the power. Rog can Roger can tell his
tiger. Is that to sit why and Roger is such a cool bastard? Is because he would any other Bond be able to get away with that? Would they be able to tell a tiger to sit and then the tiger would sit or not?
What See, whenever think? We care, whenever we compare Roger to the others, there's only one Bond that ever might do stuff that Roger might do, and that's Pierce. Mm. And I think occasionally you can see him doing stuff, but Roger can do anything. See, he now, can do anything, Roger's Bond.
If let's look at Skyfall with the Komodo dragons. Daniel's yeah. Bond looked a little bit oh. sort of shaken up by the Komodos, didn't he? Yeah. He wasn't that happy about it. Whereas no. I feel like Roger would have taken that more in his stride.
Yeah, so, I think so. He's good okay. with animals, Roger. He's good with animals.
He certainly is. Okay, so that's challenge two out of the way. We've had spiders, we've had tigers, a tiger rather. Next up, he's sort of like lying down and we get a little snake kind of slithers over his leg, to which he turns around and says, "Hiss off." How do we feel about that?
I like it. I like it, man. I think it's quite funny. And it's very so close nice. To piss off that when you're a kid, you're like, oh, you're wasting
It's naughty,
it.
Isn't it? Yeah,
yeah, it is naughty. That's
and, cool. of course, the snake does obey him and off he trots. Or off he slithers, yeah. I should say. Yeah. Next up, he encounters leeches. Now, this one's a bit more of a challenge. He gets the lighter out and he burns it off, doesn't he? Burns it off his chest. Yeah.
That's right.
So there's that one. So he's not
I've
quite
always
as...
thought. I've always well, thought with leeches as well, they're a bit... Like, they are, you know they suck your blood, they suck on, they're never going to kill you, but they're still nasty.
Yeah, you don't want to be around a leech, do you?
Yeah, no, definitely not, definitely. You wouldn't want one on the end of your knob either, would you, if he, that wouldn't be good.
You certainly, well, I don't know, it depends on how hard this is. But yeah, I digress. So we've got leeches. So he deals with that in a realistic way, doesn't he?
Yeah,
he gets
exactly.
the old lighter
That's
out,
quite cool.
burns it off.
Yeah.
And then we get a crocodile as well.
Yeah, which is at the end where he basically has to run away. And I think that's fine as well. It's just a crocodile chasing him when he runs away. So yeah, that's fine.
Do you think there could have been room for him to run across the crocodile as a little nod to his first outing? Or would that
Or maybe, much? Maybe, because he stays in the stream, doesn't he? Maybe he could have jumped over the stream and a crocodile.
Yeah.
Maybe, I don't know, maybe. Because you don't really see the crocodile much, does it? It's just
That's
chasing
true.
Him. But with all the other animals, I suppose why. So that basically is the end of the manhunt and then he goes to the boat. But there is a couple of things we have to mention in between.
Yes, there's some sneakiness. Obviously, he undoes the strap on Gabinda's
elephant. I really
elephant,
like that.
Which is nice and cool. I like him using his surroundings and taking that opportunity. Now, I think this is probably, with aside from the clown suit, this is the biggest moment where people just do a face palm, which is Bond swinging on vines, Chris.
Yes.
Now,
that
I
reminds
think,
me of someone.
I think what puts people off is not only is he swinging on vines, which, let's face it, is a a reasonable form of transport, is the fact that he decides to do a Tarzan style yell when he is in effect evading his captors. Now, talk to me about that.
Okay, so the reason he does this, Tom, in case you didn't know, is because he wanted to make people aware of where he was, because he knew that the distance away from where they were positioned meant that they wouldn't have an accurate shot. So why he knew that they would try to shoot him, but because they weren't accurate from that distance, they would waste all of their ammunition. So by the time he gets off the last vine, pretty much all the ammunition is gone, so he'd have more of a chance of surviving. Are you buying that?
I'm not sure. Maybe, I guess, because he's swinging. So it's very difficult to shoot a moving target in the first place, but swinging on vines.
That's true.
So maybe there is some logic there. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, interesting. Let's throw that one out to the JBR family. Let's see. Let's bring that up for discussion on Facebook.
Yeah. No, I mean, that I just made up on the spot. I never thought that before. but no, I think for me, the vine swinging. Okay, if that part was taken out of the film, it wouldn't make any difference, would it? I mean, if it wasn't there, that whole manhunt thing would be... It's purely play for laughs. I think the Tarzan... Could you have the vine swing without the Tarzan call? Because everyone will kind of say, well... That's where you'd use a Tarzan call because it's so associated with it.
It's Roger, though, man. Like, let's think of Moonraker, when randomly he's dressed up like a cowboy with Magnificent Seven trotting along through, true. You know, it's just totally random and weird and crazy. And that's just the start of this film. And I do think like you can let, when you don't take something in the context of what it is, you can spoil a film for yourself by letting that stuff. And it is silliness, isn't it? It's like the Tarzan yell. This isn't hardcore Fleming, is it, at the end of the day? It's silliness. But it's in the context of a more fun film. So it's like, do you then, if the Tarzan call pisses you off, does that mean you then write off the entire rest of the film?
For some people, definitely.
Like, let's compare it to Die Another Day, to me, for example.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think there was ever any one thing that made me go, ugh, I don't like this film. It was the whole package from start to finish. Yeah. I didn't get, like, I loved the concept of him being a prisoner and being all bearded and messed up, and it was like brilliant.
I like it. You're turning over a new leaf.
I always loved that concept. I thought, yes, this is new. And like when you hear the interviews with Pierce during the making of the film, in the early stages of making the film, he's talking about a completely different movie to what we got, where, you know, they're trying a harder edge thing and new stuff and all the rest of it. And it's like, again, I'm turning over a new leaf with that film because I want to tackle it with fresh eyes all these years later. But can you get Spectre is another example, isn't it? Like the people who didn't like the brother plot, that seems to spoil the whole film for them, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Which I think is a real shame because I don't think it's important enough to the plot to spoil the whole thing if that is going to spoil it for you.
Mm.
And I think it's the same thing with Octopussy in the sense that, okay, he's wearing a clown suit. Not the coolest thing in the world. Does that spoil the whole film? There's a lot of those little nuggets you could find and spoil the rest of the film if you wanted to go down that route. Tarzan, cool. Oh, it's not Fleming, this film's shit. Do you know what I mean? Or, oh, Roger's older this time. He doesn't look that cool. You know, which also, I think the thing with Roger in this film, we said in Few Eyes Only, he looks cool. He looks like a cool older dude. And do you know what I think the difference is with this one? Is the way they dress him in Octopussy, man. Well, in Few Eyes Only, he's like the wardrobe in Few Eyes Only, he looks banging for most of it. Like the scene on the beach, the Majesty's-esque scene with the buggies on the beach, man. Yeah. He looks brilliant in that scene. The scene with the yacht at the end, dragging across the corals, like he looks brilliant in that scene. Like, you know, obviously some of the outfits are a little bit dodgy, early 80s or whatever, but typically he's dressed really well. In this film, I just don't think they dress him as well. Like some of the costumes he's got on is full on safari suit styly. And I just don't think the fact that he's advancing in years at this point, coupled with that, with the wardrobe in this film, just aggravates that a little bit. I think if you dressed him a little bit cooler like they did in Few Eyes Only, they would have been better off, I think.
He gets his two dinner jacket scenes and he obviously looks good there, but you mean like you're casual but smart looking clothes, and he doesn't really get that here. It's interesting though. So obviously in terms of like the clown stuff, we'll be talking in part two.
Yeah.
We're not getting to that now. But so what is your opinion of the Tarzan call, the Tarzan and swinging on the vines?
It is silly, but it doesn't anger me. I don't sit here and watch it and be like, oh, for fuck's sake, what did they do that for? I don't feel like that about most things. Like, I don't, a lot of, you know, the penny whistle with Man with the Golden Gun, I'm like, yeah, you know what, that was a bad move. But I don't sit there and go, well, the whole stunt's ruined now. I'm like, that is a fucking brilliant stunt. That's amazing. Yeah. Still, to this day, it's amazing. So I get enough enjoyment out of this film. There's enough good in it that I'm like, doesn't really matter. It's 1 second on a film.
Yeah.
It's a bit silliness. You just sort of roll your eyes at it a little bit and get on with it. Do you know what I mean? It's like this Sotheby's scene I love so much. To me, that's the coolest part of Bond, where he's just being like, he's just taking a situation, playing outside the rules and just being the most ballsy bloke in the room. And you see, you got that Sotheby's thing, you know, you've got the backgammon scene. There's so much in here that's brilliant. Yeah. And you've got the sort of super smarminess of Roger and all that kind of stuff that I love. I proper love it. And I think it's a shame to let 1 second of a film spoil everything, because it is a bit silly, yeah, but it doesn't spoil the film for me.
No, for me too. I think it's just I actually really like the whole visually the whole manhunt. I think is brilliant. Yeah. It looks fantastic. All the elephants, everyone, all the guns, like the Tarzan thing. It is a bit silly.
And again, it's a product of the time. You know what I mean? It's like any 80s movie from this sort of time is going to have those sorts of elements in it. So it's like, and I think the mistake is when people compare this to a Casino or a License to Kill or something and write it off because of that. It wasn't meant to be that. It wasn't meant to be this hard-edged Fleming thing. It's from the outset, you could have made it like that if you wanted to, but from the outset, it was going to be a light-hearted film. So, and I mean, as a little preview for next week, because we will talk about this, obviously, I was going into the clown scene expecting it to be like, oh, here we go, this is the dodgy bit. And it didn't have quite that effect on me. And I'll obviously keep things shtum until next time. But there's my little teaser for next time. So, okay. Yeah, we'll discuss that.
This sounds good. So just to round off sort of part one, basically, so he runs away from the crocodile. He sees this sort of tour boat, doesn't he, going past, and basically wades out into the river to get on this tour boat. And Khan and Gobinda and all the elephants and all his guards and everything rock up on the sort of river edge or whatever it is, and then we get Mickey G's second cameo.
There he is.
Pretty cool. There he is. Yeah. The one where he helps him on board.
That's the one I spotted.
And there's a woman that sort of says, "You with our group?" And he's like, "No, ma'am, I'm with the economy tour," or something along those lines, which is pretty cool. And then they look around, and they see this whole sort of manhunt, you know, all the animals and the people, and they're like, I think you hear one guy say, "Do you see that guy in the turban? That's just terrific." And like, lines like that, which is quite cool. But you get one of the best lines that Kamal Khan says in the whole film.
Yeah, absolutely. Which is, "Mr. Bond is a very rare breed, soon to be made extinct."
I like that a lot. It's a great line, suits the scene. And I think it's brilliant. And then you just see Bond in the boat waving as he's going away, you know, just got out of it. So I think that whole scene's really cool. Well, obviously, one or two little silly moments, but nothing detrimental at all. I think it's really good. Just enjoyable.
Totally. I think, man, it's interesting to go back to these films, watch them from that point of view, washing away all your preconceptions and being like, right, let's watch it again as if this is the first time. Obviously, taking into account the time it was made in. And all that kind of stuff. And I do feel, man, with each of these films that we reinvestigate, I feel like I'm experiencing new things, especially for this one, because it was like, damn, there's so much that I just sort of wasn't as familiar with this time around that I have been with previous films. And there's so many preconceptions as well, man. Like the preconception for Man with the Golden Gun is that that's not as good as the other ones. And then I go in and I watch it with fresh eyes and I'm like, man, I see obviously there's some, you know, a few holes here and there, but I'm like, that film is a belter, man. Like it's hard to top a Scaramanga and those locations and all those things and knick-knack and all those cool things. And I must admit, I went in half expecting this to be like, right, okay, this is the point where things go a little bit awry or whatever, but I thoroughly enjoyed it, man. I really did, and I'm excited to get into part two.
I'm really happy that you said that, man. I really am, because I wasn't sure how you'd think. Well, I thought you were going to enjoy it, because I know it'd been a long time, so it's hard to remember sometimes how good it is. But I'm glad that you had fun. It sounds as if you're really positive about part one. So
I mean that's cool. Generally speaking, is the way I kind of like, especially with Bond, is the. It's so easy just to tear things apart. Do you know what I mean? It's you go on any forum these days and it's like people seem to enjoy being negative about Bond or whatever it is. You know what I mean? And it's easy to sit there on your high horse just ripping something apart. And I, hands up, I have done that to Die Another Day many times. And, you know, it's a natural part of things. But, like, it's easy to do that. But there's so, it's such a more rewarding experience to be like, okay, we'll look at the things we like less, but find what you enjoy about a film rather than just sit there and rip the piss out of it. Do you know what I mean? Because what does that achieve? It's like, okay, it's reasonably obvious that the Tarzan yell is a bit silly. Am I going to sit there and talk about that for half an hour? Or am I going to be like, okay, that's silly, move on to the next thing. Let's find the good in this. Do you know what I mean? That's the way I like to look at this. And I think there is a shitload of good in Octopussy. And I feel like to anybody who hasn't watched it recently, go back and watch it again and just like explore that side of things rather than, because negative energy, man, is more powerful than positive. It really is. Like if 100 people come up to you in a day and say, hello, Chris, lovely to see you today, what a lovely day. And then one dude comes up to you and goes, all right, Chris, you fucking bellend, you're going to remember that guy and he's going to ruin your day. Do you know what I mean?
It wasn't nice. It wasn't nice at all. No.
And it does seem to happen to you a lot, doesn't it?
It does, like every day, funny enough.
But and it's the same with films. It's like you can let that one little thing, whether it's the penny whistle or whatever it is, spoil the whole thing. And I think that's a real shame. And that is part of why I'm turning over my Die Another Day leaf. There's more than one thing in the film that I previously didn't like, but I'm gonna challenge myself. I'm gonna challenge myself to see the good in that when we finally get there. Whether I will succeed is another matter.
I think to a certain extent you will. I think there'll be something in there, more than one thing in there that I think you'll enjoy. But likewise to this, we don't want to go on too much about it, but you know, sort of the people that will slag off certain films all the time or whatever. This would definitely be one of them. It's a case of, that's fine if that's your thoughts. If you want to try and watch it again with fresh eyes, go for it. If you're that inclined to dislike a film or whatever it might be, just don't watch it.
Yeah, that's
if you only like the Bonds that are gritty, just watch them. Just don't bother just watching any others. If you want to, and you get people that will go, well, their thoughts have to be right.
No
one else can be. If anyone else has got a different opinion, that can't be right. And but the thing is, you're right. Negative energy is just a waste of time. It's a waste of space. If you don't like something, don't watch it. Don't bring other people down or whatever, or try to bring other people down if they're enjoying something, because they obviously can see the good in it and you can't. And that's just how it is.
That's it. And I think there's a huge amount to be said for that. And it's like that thing that we've often said about trying to please everybody, it is ultimately impossible, because no matter what choice you make, if you choose to make a gritty, hard-edged Bond thriller, you're going to alienate all the people who like the light-hearted stuff. And if you make a light-hearted one, you're going to alienate a lot of people who only like the cold, hard-edged stuff. So it's like, you just have to make a decision and go with it. And it's like, if you don't like something, it's like, well, that's kind of fine. It's like, just don't worry about it then. Just like, stick to the stuff that you do like, avoid the things you don't. And it's like, and if you sit there sort of going down that rabbit hole of saying, they shouldn't have made Octopussy because it's silly, then it's like, well, you know, there's loads of people who do love it. So there's value to it. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. 100%. Yeah. But there we go. So part one, so it's been quite, I thoroughly enjoyed part one. I'm looking forward to part two. You obviously sound the same. So,
yeah, man. Do you know what? I'm actually going to watch it again before part two, because I want to, because it's a film that I am less familiar with than usual when it comes to Bond, I want to bring it up. I want to make up for that lost time a little bit. Yeah. Cool.
Sounds good.
I like there the we go. All right. Well, we've got off on our high horses at the end there. We'll climb down. We'll climb down and do some Bond facts.
Flames, explosion, fire, Bond facts.
What have you got for us this week then, Crispy Pants?
Okay, I've got some good ones here. So Bond fact number one, an early draft of the script cast Octopussy as a villain using her research on Tracy Bond's death to manipulate Bond into joining her vendetta against Spectre. The ongoing legal battle with Kevin McClory put paid to that. Now, this one I'd never heard of before.
No.
It's I don't know how far they got with the idea, but again, bringing Spectre back and having Octopussy a part of it. Because I guess if you're thinking about the Octopussy story, didn't her dad kill Major Dexter Smythe? Didn't he kill Franz Oberhauser? Who had the gold?
Okay, so Franz Oberhauser, Franz Oberhauser was a fresh character for Spectre. Hans Oberhauser.
Oh, Hans.
Was the
I beg your pardon. Yeah.
So basically, Hans as well. That's an interesting point because she does mention the original Octopussy story in this.
Yeah.
This would be in part two, but
yeah, sorry. Yeah.
Basically, the story, the Fleming story, was Bond goes to see Dexter Smythe, who's in Jamaica, if I remember correctly, and there was basically some lost Nazi gold involved during the World War Two. Dexter Smythe shot somebody. Shot Hans Oberhauser, that's right. He shoots Hans Oberhauser and his body fell into a glacier or
crevice.
Something that then melted and his body came out years later. They traced it back to Dexter Smythe and it was to do with stolen Nazi gold.
Yeah.
Bond goes to see him and basically Bond gives him a gun with one bullet in and says, I can either take you in or you do the honourable thing.
Yeah, or you
Bond walks outside, you hear the gunshot, Hans Oberhauser's dead.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry, Dexter Smythe is dead.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And in this story, Dexter Smythe is Octopussy's dad, yet they've changed it a bit. Where Bond says he caught up with Dexter Smythe in Sri Lanka rather than Jamaica. And what else is
it? I guess it filmed in India.
There's basically a couple of the details of the plot were changed. Maybe it wasn't Nazi gold, it was something to do with the Russians or something like that.
But there's that potential link then between Octopussy and Spectre with Hans Oberhauser and Major Dexter Smythe. It's interesting, isn't it? So potentially, like Octopussy's dad killed Blofeld's dad.
There's a whole storyline kicking off right there, isn't it?
Completely, man. Yeah. It's just one of those crazy things. But yeah, so that is an interesting thing. Obviously, when they were going back then, Hans Oberhauser had nothing to do with Spectre.
Yeah.
That's obviously due to the new film, but just an interesting thing. Okay, so bomb fact number two, the quip at the end of the opening sequence where he says, fill her up, was initially removed by John Glenn. They played it to a local cinema and everyone loved it, so he put it back in, which is cool. Bomb fact number three, the Fabergé egg as seen in the movie was actually the Imperial Coronation Egg. This was designed, as everyone knows, by Peter Carl Fabergé. The egg is also known as Lilies of the Valley, but it is never called this in the film. And almost 20 years later, the same egg reappeared in the movie Ocean's 12.
There we go.
Character number, bomb fact number four. The character of Penelope Smallbone was named after one of the models who appeared in the opening titles of The Spy Who Loved Me. She called herself Perry Small, although her real name was Penelope Smallbone. She revealed her true identity to Cubby Broccoli, who basically borrowed it for Octopussy, which is quite cool. And there's a famous thing how during one of the scenes that they were filming, Lewis Maxwell flubbed a line by saying, calling her Penelope Smallbush instead of Smallbone, causing Roger to reply, "We know where your mind has been, Miss Moneypenny," which must have been quite a cool day to be on set to see that. Bomb fact number five, permission to shoot in the region of Udaipur had to be sought and granted from the reigning royal Maharana, Bhagwat Singh. He would frequently entertain the A-list cast and crew at dinners during production where they'd be served specially made rose wine.
Very nice.
Which sounds rather tasty. Now, this is quite interesting. Bomb fact number six, another actor was hired in addition to Vijay Amritaj when there was a dispute with the Aqua's equity, because Armitage, he was a tennis player, obviously was an actor. He wasn't a member of the actors' union. But Cubby Broccoli stepped in an artist friend, Leonard Goldberg, to arrange like a guest appearance on a fantasy island, obviously that Hervé Villechaize was part of. And then he got his SAG membership and then he could appear in Octopussy.
Interesting.
On fact number seven, the company tuk-tuk taxi used to pick up 007 was specially constructed at Pinewood Studios and capable of speeds in excess of 70 miles an hour. Now,
very
would
nice.
You like to go down the M11 or the M1 or the M4 and see a tuk-tuk bombing past us?
I would. I must admit, here in Thailand, I've been riding tuk-tuks quite a lot recently, so it will be have good you? To get one that's got some serious welly behind it, yeah.
Have you asked anyone to try and pull a wheelie?
Or? I haven't. Maybe I will, yeah.
Yeah, if you get them drunk, I remember when I lived in Thailand a while back, and I remember being in a tuk-tuk chase. It's not a chase.
Why have you not told me that before?
A tuk-tuk chase, that would have been amazing. I remember being in a tuk-tuk and the driver must have been, I think he was definitely off his head. He was definitely drunk. And he started doing mini wheelies, which were probably really dangerous at the time. Yeah. But I remember thinking it was quite cool. But anyway, so bomb fact number eight, Kamal notes that Bond likes eggs, preferably Fabergé. Although this could also be a reference to the books where Bond is partial to some scrambled eggs. So that might be a nice little inside bit there. Now, this one I didn't actually know. Bomb fact number 9, when Bond bends the metal bars surrounding the window of the Monsoon Palace, there is a really brief musical cue from Superman, from the Superman theme, but it's done really slow, so it's not obvious. But when you listen to it, it's there. You know, obviously he's pulling the bars, and it's like, but it's not.
That's obvious. A very Roger era thing to do, isn't it? Yeah. So
that's it. Another film musical cue, which is quite cool. Now, here we're getting on to some serious stuff now. So this is a final Bond fact number 10. But this one, I really don't know how many people know about.
Okay.
In a break with tradition, Roger Moore uses the 9mm Walther P5 compact throughout the film. He doesn't use a Walther PPK. The only time we see the Walther PPK is within the title scene when he's holding it and the girl, the model in the title scene, is holding it. The rest of the time.
Do you mean in the title sequence?
Yeah, in the the actual titles.
Yeah.
Obviously, we don't see him with one in the actual pre-titles, but in the titles, you know, where, you know, that's when we see a PPK. But in the film, he uses a Walther P5. And I think the Walther were obviously trying to get their, you know, that was their new model. They were trying to sort of get some exposure for it, even though it's never referred to in the film. Now, there are a couple of interesting things about this.
He does say, "I've misplaced my PPK to Q," though, doesn't he?
He does. Yeah. Now, in the tuk-tuk chase, it's that thug, I think, with a star dagger, knocks the gun out of his hand.
Yeah.
And he says to Q, "I've misplaced my PPK." But the gun that he was using was actually a P5. It wasn't a PPK.
So it's a Walther P5. I just assumed, gets the PPK out of his pocket in the tuk-tuk, it gets knocked away. That's when he misplaces it, and then it's replaced with a P5.
Which is what would have made sense. Yeah. But apparently that was also a P5 beforehand.
Interesting.
Interestingly as well, in Never Say Never Again, Sean Connery used a P5, a Walther P5, for his portrayal at Bond, obviously the same sort of time.
Mm.
Benicio del Toro used one as Dario in License to Kill. And it's also the standard issue gun of the Netherlands police until 2013, when it was replaced by the P99, which he obviously used in Die Another Day.
Very nice.
Now, that got me looking into some other firearm-related sort of material. Now, this is really interesting. In Dr. No, although Bond is supposedly issued with a PPK, he is actually provided with a longer-barreled Walther PP. So in Dr. No, he doesn't even use a PPK.
Is that so?
Yeah, he uses a Walther PP, and so does Felix Leiter. So there isn't a PPK in that film. They both use a Walther PP, and it's a slightly longer barrel than the PPK version. Not very similar,
but
it's a slightly longer barrel. So that's one interesting thing. Another interesting thing, the Beretta that Bond hands back to M in Dr. No is an M1934 9mm quarto. Now, that Beretta that he gives back to M is actually superior to the PPK, supposedly, that he gets given. So
really?
He's given a gun that's not as good as the PPK that he's receiving, because in the novel, the Beretta that he used was an earlier model, and it was inferior to the PPK in the model. But the one that they used in the film, the Beretta, was actually supposedly better than the PPK.
Which is
kind of strange, isn't it?
Yeah.
And then lastly, around the whole sort of Bond thing, in From Russia with Love, Bond does have a PPK, and so does Karen Bay. So From Russia with Love onwards, he uses a PPK and not the PP. But if Karen Bay uses a PPK, which he does, does that mean that Valentin Sukovsky and not Red Grant actually killed Karen Bay? Because he knows three people that uses a gun, and he's killed two. And Bond was still alive. So maybe Sukovsky actually killed Karen Bay, and he was on the train at that time and did a job for Red Grant.
And of course, you know, the Russians were involved in that whole caper From Russia with Love. Valentin Sukovsky is Russian.
Yeah.
It was Russian. Maybe he did. Yeah, but then again, only three men he knows use such a gun.
So maybe he knew others.
Yeah.
No, that's true. That's true. But there
excellent
we go.
So, firearm related research there, Chris. I'm impressed.
And if you want to know any more, there is Internet Movie Firearm Database.
Very nice. Cool stuff. All right, then, excellent set of Bond facts for us this week, Chris. Moving on, I think it's time we answer our Bond trivia questions, don't you?
Bond trivia. Yes, sounds good. So you went first, I believe.
Good stuff. Now, my question of the day is, Mr. Christopher Wright, how many times do we see Bond on horseback across the entire Bond series?
Now, this is tricky. It's a bloody good question, first of all. Really, really good question. If I tell you a few, will you tell me how many you have? Don't tell me how many you have now.
Okay.
So the ones that come to mind, obviously Octopussy, when he's going towards the plane at the end, is one. Living Daylights, when they're on the horses with the Russians and the drugs, is another. I don't know if you're allowed to say never again, jumping off the sort of thing at the end. Yep. Okay. I just had one in my mind. Where's that gone? Where's that gone? Oh, obviously A View to a Kill, the horses.
Yep.
Doing the thingamabobby. I had another one. Where is that gone? It was in my mind a minute ago. That's so weird.
Would you like to know how many there are left?
Yeah, go on then.
In total, I have six. That it does include.
You have six. So I've said four. Yeah. So it doesn't, or it does include.
It does include. Never say.
Okay, so I've got two more to get, and one of them was just in my head. Let me think.
I can give you a slight nudge in that it might have come up in today's episode.
Oh, okay. That's blank me. Shit, I literally had it in my head and I was ready to say
it. I'm going to have to start doing the countdown clock, Chris.
Yeah, I know. This is bad. All right, let me think. Does he have one in... Does he have one? I'm sure Rog has another time that he does it.
He does.
Yeah, let me think. So, is it Spy Rides a Camel? Moonray. No, go on. I had one of the two in my head, but it's just gone. It's just mine.
Well, the other one.
Give me little clues.
He might have been dressed as a cowboy while he was riding one.
Oh, yeah, of course it was. Of course. That was the one that I had in my mind from earlier, but I can't think of the other one.
The other one. This is, I thought this would be the one I'd catch you out on.
Right.
But if I told you that Sheila James would probably be able to tell you which one it was.
Oh, of course it is on the love montage. Oh, silly me.
Majesty's love montage. That's very briefly, you see him on horseback.
Of course he is. That's a great question, man. Oh, you did me on those. The Moonraker one I had, but it slipped.
Just to recap Majesty's during the love montage, Moonraker when he's dressed as a cowboy with the Magnificent Seven soundtrack, Never Say Never Again, obviously, when they do the big jump and all the, you know, off the roof. Octopussy, just before he jumps on the back of the plane at the very end, View to a Kill during the, you know, the racing sequence, and obviously the Living Daylights in Afghanistan as well. And that's as many as I can think of. I don't think there are any more, but if anybody spots
one, let us know. Could Danny Boy pull off a horse scene?
I could see him doing that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It'd be interesting to see. Or whoever else comes along. Cool. Okay, good. Well, not too bad. I missed those two. But so my question was, let me go back to it again. My question was, Mr. Tom Sears, now, when Kamal Khan threatens to extract information from Bond, what methods does Bond suggest Kamal will use on him?
I can't remember. It's some sort of chemical, isn't it, that makes you tell the truth, but it leaves you with permanent brain damage. I can't remember what it's called.
But what does... That's what Khan says he will use, but what does Bond tell Khan... What does Bond say he thinks Khan will use on it?
It's gone. Can't
tricky
do it.
Ones. Okay. Yeah. So first of all, he says thumbscrews and hot coals. And then Khan is like, hardly, we're far more sophisticated than that. So that was the first thing he said. And then the second potential answer was sodium pentothal. And Kamal Khan said very crude and a little crude, very unreliable. Now, thumb screws, everyone knows what that is. Stick a thumb ink screw is bad. Hot coals, very bad. Now, sodium pentothal, do you know what that is?
No, I don't.
Okay, so it's basically a supposed truth serum that people use sometimes in the military and what have you. It's an ultra short acting barbiturate and is still used in some places as a truth serum. It weakens the resolve of the subject, making them more compliant when people sort of pressurize them. So the barbiturates, they decrease the higher cortical brain functioning. We're getting into the science mode.
Very nice.
And some psychiatrists hypothesize that because lying is more complex than telling the truth, because you have to fabricate whatever it is you're saying. Mm. Suppression of the higher cortical functions may lead to uncovering of the truth. So you can't think of a lie because your brain's not functioning properly, so you have to say the truth. The drug tends to make subjects loquacious and cooperative with interrogators. However, the reliability of the confessions made under it is questionable, as obviously Khan alludes to, because sometimes people might just be saying stuff they don't know if they're off their head a little bit.
That's interesting. I always just assumed truth serum was just this made up thing, but there is, like, it's not quite what it's made out to be in the movies, but from that description, there is a basis.
There are various things. Yeah, there are various things. So that's the thing that Khan said is not reliable. But the thing that he said he was going to use, now this was curare. Now, it's used as a paralyzing poison by South American indigenous people. The prey is shot by the arrows or blowgun darts, which are dipped in curare, which is extracted from plants. So it's a poison, basically, and it causes asphyxiation and the inability for people to breathe properly. So it was introduced as an anesthetic in the early 1940s to relax muscles, but obviously they then found out it was a bit dodgier than they thought. But curare, it basically depends on its intended use, but if you take it orally, it's fine, but if it gets into your bloodstream, then you're screwed. So basically that would make Bond paralyzed almost, and then the psychedelic compound would probably screw up his brain a little bit, and that would be the damaging effect, so he'd be out of it and stuff like that. So it's those sort of things where you never quite, unless you look into it, it's interesting just to find out sort of the scientific and side behind
this it. Is one of those things, isn't it, where you're learning things from Bond, isn't it? It's like you've investigated that now, and now you're richer for it, having the knowledge of what these things are and what they do, and that we've learned that truth serum is actually, in a roundabout sense, a thing. Yeah.
So I might get some and try it on my housemates. And
it sounds like a good laugh, man.
Yeah. If nothing else, it'll be funny.
Yeah, good stuff. So moving on then, it's time for the Guess the Quote round.
Bon, 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 bon. James Bond.
Now, last week it was my quote, wasn't it?
Oh, yes. Yes.
Now I'm going to perform it for you again. Okay. Are you ready for it?
I am, yes. Please, far away.
My quote from last time was, did you call the auto club?
I'm
reasonably certain you're going to get that straight away.
I think I might do. I've got a very strong suspicion who it might be, and I think it is the German accent which really helps things. I know Ralph would be loving this if he's listening right now.
Yeah, absolutely.
He'd be able to nail that. But I think it is Dr. Kaufman in Tomorrow Never Dies.
It certainly is. Obviously, where he's got Bond at gunpoint, the cronies and Stamper are trying to get into his BMW, but they're getting electric shocks and all that kind of stuff. Brilliant. I do like that bit of humour in that sequence where he's like, it's very embarrassing. I don't know what to say. I like that.
He is good. Yeah, I look forward to that. Okay, so I've got a new quote for you this time. Are you ready?
I am indeed.
Okay, so my quote for this week is, the cold word is not, I repeat, not intimate. Do you want me to say that again?
Yes, and I know it. I'm just struggling to place the film. I think I might have it. Go on, do it again.
The cold word is not, I repeat, not imminent.
I can see the dude's face. You know those scenes sometimes where it'll open up and there'll be like a United Nations meeting or something.
Yeah.
And there's been several of those across the years. And then sometimes they just blend in and you're like, oh, what film was that one from? And you get them mixed up. But I'm reasonably confident I've got that.
Okay, sounds good. I like the confidence there. So we had a listener quote last time. Should we have a listen to that again? And then we'll have a little guess.
Let's do it.
You're mad. You know that.
Okay, good stuff. Are you on the scent with that one?
I think I've got an idea. It's one of those ones where it's definitely trickier than your average quote. But I think I've got a strong idea. What about yourself? Ringing any bells?
I'm going to go with, I think it might be, I, I, It sounds familiar, but I don't have it in my head. I think it could be maybe Ruby Bartlett in Honor Majesties or one of the Angels of Death in Majesties.
Yeah.
Something like that.
It's definitely a woman. I was thinking maybe from... Do you remember in Thunderball when they're in the Kiss Kiss Club and Bond is being, you know, being hunted down by Fiona and the others.
Right.
And he wants to create a distraction and he basically grabs a woman. Do you want to dance or something like that? And grabs her. And then they go to dance and she's a bit like, haha, you're mad. You know that.
And then, okay. That
I think that might
now.
Be it. And then right. I think he says, yes, isn't everyone? Or something like that. Why did all I right. say that in the original voice?
Right. Should we have a listen then?
Yeah.
All right. Let's see what the answer is.
Hi guys. It's Chris Emery calling back with the answer to my listener quote. So if you got it, brilliant. If not, it's from Thunderball, and it's when James Bond is on the run from Fiona Volpe and her henchmen. He grabs a woman in the Kiss Kiss Club and drags her onto the dance floor for a dance, and she comes out with, ha ha, you're mad, you know that. Oh, aren't we all a little? So anyway, keep up the good work. Love listening to the podcast, and I'll call back with another one if I think of one.
So there you go. You got that in one, Chris. Well done.
Yeah. Now that was played by Diane Hartford, and she was the one who was also in Casino Royale. You know, there were a couple who were back in those days, like from You Only Live Twice. Who was Madame
Ling
Zoom,
was in it, wasn't it? Yeah
Ling, who was Madame Wu, I think, in Casino. Now this one was even 1 year longer, and she played obviously that girl in Thunderball, and she was, I think, she was the one around the Texas Hold'em table, not the main one, but you know where he wins his DB5 off what's his face, Dimitros. I think she's one of the ones around that table, so that's quite cool.
Sweet. Thing.
Okay, so we've got a new JBR listener quote for this week, and here it is.
Hey guys, it's Jack Taylor from across the pond with today's listener quote, so here he goes. Gently, my friend, gently. Hopefully you guys can all get that one, and thanks, Tom and Chris, for all you guys do. Keep up the great work.
What do you think about that, then?
It does ring a bell. I think there's somebody in mind I have with that. I'm not 100% if I've got it, but that rings a bell of who might have said that. Yeah,
it's a cool quote, isn't it? It's a cool quote. I like it. Yeah. I like it. So that was really cool. We'll have to have some guesses about that.
Good stuff. All right, we'll obviously reveal the answer to that next time. So now it is time for.
Who wrote the song? Who lived and died? Who played Helga Branton? How did she die? Who wants to stop while the water in the Nivea? It's Tommy Trivia.
Okay, so Tommy Trivia, are you ready, Tom?
I am indeed. Just for any new listeners, this is where Chris takes me through one card from the 007 Trivial Pursuit deck to test my Bondian knowledge. Sometimes these questions are ridiculously easy. Sometimes they're surprisingly difficult. That's a new word. And sometimes they're wrong, and we correct the Trivial Pursuit peoples. So... lay it on me, Chris. What have you got for me this time?
So first question, we have cast and characters. Who played Felix Leiter in Thunderball?
That would be Rick Van Nutter.
Yes! Excellent stuff. Okay, on to the films. What is the name of Zorin's master plan?
Main Strike?
Yeah, Operation.
Operation Main Strike, yes.
Yes, I'll definitely give you that. Okay, vehicles. Who is in the boot of the Aston Martin DBS in Quantum of Solace?
Mr. White, of course.
Yes, indeed. Okay, on to gadgets and weapons. What tune does Bond whistle to activate the stun gas from his key fob in The Living Daylights?
That would be Rule Britannia.
And could you give us an example of such, please? He knocked me out. Okay, so on to locations. Where is Goldfinger's stud farm?
Kentucky.
Yeah, go, you're flying through these. Okay, so we've got one more. See if you can get this. This is crew and behind the scenes. Tom says, who directed The World Is Not Enough?
That would be Michael Apted.
Aha. Uh-huh. Straight
I got four marks this week, didn't I? There was no discrepancies. There was no mishearing. No hesitation. No nothing. It was good.
I'm impressed, Tom. That is probably your most professional round yet.
Good stuff.
Very good.
Maybe it's time for me to go on Mastermind after all this.
I think so. Yeah. Cool. Good stuff. So moving on. Next one we've got is...
It's the music cue.
All right, then. There we are. That was last week's music cue. Now, you're looking not puzzled, but you know, not 100% certain. What are you thinking?
It's a mysterious one, isn't it?
It is. It's a cool piece of music.
It is, and I'm not 100% sure, actually, what era it's from. That could have been Spectre, as far as I'm concerned, or it could have been probably not as far back as Dr. No, but like...
Could you give me a decade? What sort of... What's your gut instinct say decade-wise?
I'd say it could be anything from the 80s onwards. Is it from the Daniel era?
No, I'd say go with your gut. What the very
so
first
the 80s?
Said. Yes, from the 80s.
Okay.
Now, who do you think the potential composer might be?
I would say that's probably John Barry then.
It is. So that knocks out two of the other 80s films.
It does. So it's either Octopussy, which I don't think it is because I've just watched that. I'd say it's either Living Daylights or View to a Kill. Am I on the right track
there? I'd say you're right. I'd say you've got a 50-50.
And my gut feeling tells me it's a View to a Kill. Is that right or not?
It's definitely from the Living Daylights. But there is a cue in a View to a Kill, which is very similar to this. Like you said earlier on, actually, there's some overlap between those two with the soundtracks.
Is it then? So if it's Living Daylights, is it...
I can give you
is
a
it
clue
perhaps
if you
when Kara goes into the phone booth and does a little change, or when Bond goes into the toilet with the case?
No, it's definitely a scene with Kara.
Okay.
It's a little bit later on in the film, and Bond
is it when she poisons him?
Yes, when she drugs him. Good man.
Very
so
nice.
She gives him like the vodka martini. He has a drink, and you know he starts to feel a bit queasy. You know, not quite right. And then that music sort of kicks in. It's kind of nice because it feels kind of as if his head's going a bit.
That's it.
We're spot on. Excellent stuff.
Good stuff.
Okay, so we do have a new music cue for this week. Would you like to hear it?
Yeah, let's do it.
I think this one you probably get quite easily. I think this one in comparison.
Sure.
So you're looking pretty confident on that one then.
Yes, so. I am. Yes. I would wager that this is somewhere I have been reasonably recently within the last few months or so, which excites me a lot. Good stuff. All right.
Cool. Leo. Excellent. Okay. Well, we'll find out about that next week then.
Cool. All right. Good stuff. Music cue. We'll find out the answer in 2 weeks' time. Good stuff. So that brings us to the new round of... What's the next line?
Pew, 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 pew.
Good stuff.
Cool.
Okay, now I think it's my turn this week. Is that right?
No, it's actually my turn. Last week. You did. But I tell you what, Tom, I have got a magic what's the next line for you this week.
Oh, have you?
And I don't even think... You'll need a second go. If you want to have the second go, you can. So the rules are, one of us, like in this instance, so it's my turn, I'll say a line of dialogue, and Tom has to follow up with the reply of whatever character it might be. Now, normally we'll say it once to let it sink in, we'll say it a second time, and then the other person can say it. But if you want to go for it first time, feel free to go ahead, okay? Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Okay. Thank you. But I think my mouth is too big.
Ah, yes. All right. Sorry, I got excited. That obviously isn't the answer, what I just said.
Oh, yes.
So, can you imagine if it was? Oh, yes.
Okay, so we'll do that again, and you've got to go with the next line. Okay,
yes.
Are you ready? Thank you, but I think my mouth is too big.
No, it's the right size. For me, that is.
Whoa, very nice. Excellent.
Good stuff.
Good stuff. Do you like that one?
I do, and we have debated on whether he is in fact referring to his penis in that with that statement or not. What side of the fence do you fall down on there?
100% on the penis side.
Yeah, it must be.
I'd say so.
Good stuff.
Cool. So there we are. So you get what's the next line next week.
Good stuff. Excellent. So it's time for Bond Girl Battle.
Oh, James.
One rises to meet a challenge.
Very good. I like it. Okay, so last time was the fourth round, and which Melina Havelock won straight through. So what we do is I've got a lovely list of Bond girls here from various card games and what have you. So I go through them. Tom tells me to stop, and we bring out three at a time, and then we have a battle to see who we think is the best Bond girl.
Yes.
Now, this is mainly looking at the Bond girl character, but if we think there's a tie, then we can go to how hot they are.
Indeed. Okay. Yes.
Right, so if I start shoveling, you tell me to stop, and I'll take
one. Okay, stop.
Okay. Okay.
Stop.
Okay, and one more.
Stop.
Okay, right. So I've got my three Bond girls, and they are... Okay, so the first one that comes out of the hat is... Oh, this is going to take some beating. Solitaire from Live and Let Die.
Oh, my goodness gracious. All right. Okay.
Oh, that's tough. Okay, second one out of the hat is... Agent Strawberry Fields, Quantum of Solace.
Okay, very nice. Okay,
so we got two good ones there. And finally, we have... Whew, interesting, this mixes it up a bit. We have two. We have Vida and Zora, the fighting gypsy girls from Russia with Love.
Interesting. Sorry. Yes.
Yeah, so we've got a... So we've got a double there. We've got Agent Fields and we've got Solitaire. So what do we think?
Right, okay, let's break this down then. So let's start with Solitaire.
Yep.
So she has the power of seeing into the future, which is quite...
She does.
She doesn't anymore, but she did. Yeah. She has the power of being absolutely stunningly beautiful, let's face it.
That she still has that now as well. Yeah, that hasn't faded.
Yes.
That has not faded one moment.
Absolutely, like, yes. That's stunning. An excellent investment. Yeah. Totally. What else has she got? Do we see her in action at all? Do we see her, like, you know,
she's
get
quite
the job
brave.
Done?
She's holding on to that bus the whole time during the bus chase.
She does hold on to the bus. You're right. Yes.
And that is true. She's not as bad as Rosie Carver when it comes to scarecrows. She's all right.
Yes. Okay, yes. So
she looks amazing in pretty much anything, which is...
Yeah,
which is
I feel like we're regressing to the old rule set.
I know though, we are. I know we are.
Which is fine. I'm all right with it this week. Yeah. Right, okay. All right, so let's put Solitaire to one side for a minute. Let's look at Strawberry Fields.
Cool.
How do we feel about Strawberry Fields?
So she's more of a cameo sort of thing in terms of she's not in it a huge amount, but she's like basically working for MI6. She's not an agent as such, but she's there to bring Bond back and basically falls for his charms and ends up bedding him and suffers the consequences. So it's more of a minor role. I know she divides people, actually.
I would say she is from the old school mode of A Merry Goodnight or the last half of Diamonds Tiffany Case. Which I say is not a bad thing. Like, you can have those people exist in the world, so we can have them in films. So yes, she literally shows up and says, "I'm to bring you in, James," and he's like, "No," and she's like, "Oh, all right then," and that's as far as she goes. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I don't feel like she's not.
She does. Well, she does trip up Elvis, doesn't she? Oops,
she does
sorry.
Trip up Elvis. Yes, she does. Yeah, that's true.
Not a big thing.
She looks good in a trench coat.
She does.
That's probably it, really.
Yeah, it's just not much there, is there beyond that, to be honest. So, what about Vida and Zora?
Well, I feel like they would win hands down in terms of combat, because I mean they're pretty rough and ready, aren't they? In terms of fighting,
definitely. They are definitely both of them.
One thing that does work in their favour is that when Bond's deciding, obviously they are both presented to him by the gypsy man, and it's heavily implied that he's going to sort of road test the both of them and see which one is the best. So definite points in their favour for that, because, you know, that's great.
Yeah, but they also are in love with the same man, or that they are fighting over.
Yeah.
But does Bond then make them love him and not the other man?
Definitely. That is definitely what happens.
Yeah, I think it's got to be, hasn't it? Yeah. So, I mean, they're like you said, battle-wise, they'd be good. The fact there are two of them is pretty cool. Both hot, both like really good, that sort of thing. A solitaire, man. I think.
Do you know what, man? I know we're breaking our own rules. We're going back. Yeah. We're going back to what we said we wouldn't do. But I can't let anybody but solitaire through, man. I just can't do it.
Yeah. I don't think it's possible. But also, she's the main Bond girl character. She the does other have two in this competition.
That does work in her favor. The other two are cameos. The other three, actually,
and also she's the Bond girl that Bond bonks more than any of the others on screen. So he does it four times. Wow. Solitaire.
Excellent staying power there from Sir Roger.
That's not bad at all. And no sense in going off half cocked.
Indeed.
But she has got other. She's definitely got other assets too, I was going to say.
It is
difficult. But she's also cool. She's how can we forget? She's brilliant at cards anyway. You know, she beats Bond at Jim Rami, didn't she?
Yes, like, she does. With him.
So she'd be good to take to a casino and she gamble. She'd probably win, like swipe the floor of the casino. So that's good. She'd be interesting to talk to about her awareness of the supernatural.
Yes, like that would be foremost on my mind.
Should we just say solitaire wins? Come on,
solitaire wins.
So, right. So solitaire wins. Solitaire round five winner. She's through to the next round.
Good stuff.
We have to say goodbye to Agent Fields and Vida and Zora, but they've played well. Well,
just out of interest, on the top trumps cards there, what's her cleavage score?
99. Oh, she's actually there is actually a seduction one. So seduction, it might be out of 50 because Vida and Zora are 31, Agent Fields is 33, Seduction for Solitaire, 44.
Oh, there you go.
Brutality, 20, interested. Twisted Mind, 10. Starling Charm, 6. Threat to the World, 0. So she's not a threat to the world. Yeah. Whereas Agent Fields is Threat to the World, 50. Why is she a threat to the world? Is she a threat to the world? I really don't know. But anyway, Seduction, 44. We'll go with that. Lovely jubbly. There we are.
All right, good stuff. So congratulations to Solitaire. She joins the next round. Good stuff. So that about rounds out today's episode of James Bond Radio. We'll be back in 2 weeks, obviously, with Octopussy Part 2, which is all very exciting. As I say, I'm going to watch the film again for a second time before we do that, so I'm nice and fresh for the last half of the film. I'm excited for that. Are you excited for that?
I am, and I'm going to do the same. I'll watch it again and go through, and I'm looking forward to it because Part 1... I liked so much of Part 1. I think there's so much that it's got to offer. And I think Part 2, you know, it is a different setting. You've got the Germany, you've got, you've got their circus. There's a brief bit back to Indu at the end. But I don't know if it'll be a different feel, but I don't know if that will make it any worse or any better. So it'll be interesting to see. But I'm really looking forward to it. And I'm so chuffed that you enjoyed Part 1. I'm really happy.
Good stuff.
But I'll tell you why. I'll do a full review after Part 2. But for me, I think like we said before, it's because Octopussy is fun. I think I cannot watch that film without a smile. There are so many good scenes. It covers tense scenes, action scenes, funny scenes. And also, you know, some Bond films are guilty pleasures.
Mm.
For some people, it's Diamonds. You know, Diamonds is often stated as not a very good film. You know, sometimes I previously hadn't looked on it too favourably, but there are good bits in it. And that's a guilty pleasure for some. A View to a Kill is the same for others. For me, I think my guilty pleasure is Octopussy. If I just want to sit down, watch a Bond, and smile all the way through it, that's the one that I'll put on.
Cool.
And I think that's why it's good. But I'm really looking forward to Part 2.
Excellent work. All right, then. Good stuff. We will return in 2 weeks' time with Octopussy Part 2. James Bond Radio will return. Until then, I've been Tom Sears.
I've been Chris Wright.
And we'll see you then. Take it easy.
Well, indeed.
Bye.